Let me quickly go on to invite our speaker today, Mr. Uday Kumar. Uday Kumar, thank you for joining us. To give you a quick introduction of Uday Kumar, of course, his best introduction is that he's my friend. I think that is the most important introduction. But for other things, he's a passionate Bangalorean and an accidental historian and a conservationist. Right? History is his hobby. He loves to research lesser known aspects of the city's history, right? After researching about the history, he has noticed that as the city is growing and booming, a lot of the history is being damaged or destroyed. So he works very hard to conserve history, conserve these pieces of history. His favorite interest is inscription stones and the stories that they tell. He's an accidental historian. He has a background in engineering. He's a master's from IIT Chennai, worked for the Tata's, GE, Schneider Electric, etc. His work on Bangalore's history has been extensively covered by media and newspapers. You'll find many, many articles about his work. And last year, Namma Bengaluru Citizen Group awarded him the Individual of the Year 2019. Every time I listen to Uday, it is very, very exciting. So, welcome Uday. Thanks for joining us and following Shivanand Bellareji. Silent clap from all of us. Thank you. I will request all of us to go on mute. Yeah, please go on mute. And over to you, Uday. We are waiting for the 1,000 years of storytelling that we want to hear from you.
Okay. So, thank you, Badri, and thank you, everyone. I noticed that a lot of people can speak Kannada here as well. So, I'm assuming I can use a bit of Kannada in this talk. Stop me if you think that. All right. Thank you so much. So, let's get started.
Uday, do you want me to mute everybody?
Yes. Yes. Please.
Yeah. I'll do that. One second. Let me unmute you. I guess we want to unmute you. Yeah.
Okay. So you should be able to see the slide as well as hear me now.
Yes, we do. Go ahead.
All right. Thank you so much. So, ellarigu, dhanyavadagalu. Na ee avakasha maadikottidakkagi Bengaluru matte nimma pradeshagalu Kormangala HSR suttumuttalin pradeshagalu bagge maatadadakke. A few points before we start. Just a simple thing, points. In case you are on a wireless connection, I request you to try and switch to a wired connection. Buffering and all these latency issues will not be there so much on your wired connection. Muting, I think Badri is taking care of. Please mute your mics. Switch off your videos if you don't need it as well. If you're leaving on the videos, and this is a common problem on webinars these days, ದಯವಿಟ್ಟು ಏನಾರ ಬಟ್ಟೆ ಹಾಕೊಂಡಿದ್ದೀರಾ ಗಮನಿಸಿ ನೋಡಿ, ಸಾಕಷ್ಟು ಜನ ಈಗೆಲ್ಲ ಮರ್ತು ಬರ್ತಾರೆ ವಿಡಿಯೋ ಕಾಲ್ ಇದು ಅಂತ ಹೇಳಿ. ಇಫ್ ಯು ಆರ್ ಆನ್ ಎ ಟ್ಯಾಬ್ಲೆಟ್, ಇಟ್ಸ್ ಬೆಟರ್ ಯು ಸ್ವಿಚ್ ಟು ದಿ ಏನೋ ದಿ ಲ್ಯಾಂಡ್ಸ್ಕೇಪ್ ಮೋಡ್, ವಿಚ್ ಇಸ್ ಈ ತರ ಐಡಿಯಾ ಬದಲಾಗಿ ಈ ತರ ಇಡಿದ್ರೆ ನಿಮ್ಗೆ ಅನುಕೂಲ, ಸ್ಲೈಡ್ಸ್ ಎಲ್ಲ ಚೆನ್ನಾಗಿ ಕಾಣುತ್ತೆ. ಅಂಡ್ ಕ್ವಶನ್ಸ್ ಐ ವಿಲ್ ಟೇಕ್ ದಮ್ ಇನ್ ದ ಎಂಡ್, ಬಟ್ ಇಫ್ ಯು ಹ್ಯಾವ್ ಕ್ವಶನ್ಸ್ ಯು ಕ್ಯಾನ್ ಆಲ್ಸೋ ಚಾಟ್ ಇಟ್, ಯು ನೋ ಟೈಪ್ ದಮ್ ಔಟ್ ಇನ್ ದ ಚಾಟ್ ವಿಂಡೋ ಅಂಡ್ ಐ ವಿಲ್ ಟೇಕ್ ದಮ್ ಅಟ್ ದ ಎಂಡ್ ಅಗೇನ್. ಮೋಸ್ಟ್ ಆಫ್ ದಿಸ್ ಟಾಕ್ ವಿಲ್ ಬಿ ಇನ್ ಕನ್ನಡ ಆರ್ ಇಂಗ್ಲಿಷ್, ಎ ಲಿಟಲ್ ಬಿಟ್ ಆಫ್ ತಮಿಳ್ ಇನ್ ಒನ್ ಆರ್ ಟೂ ಪ್ಲೇಸಸ್, ಜಸ್ಟ್ ಅ ಫ್ಯೂ ವರ್ಡ್ಸ್. ಓಕೆ. ಆಲ್ಮೋಸ್ಟ್ ಯು ನೋ ಎವ್ರಿಬಡಿ ಈಸ್ ವೆರಿ ಇನ್ಕ್ವಿಸಿಟಿವ್, ಹೌ ಡಿಡ್ ಯು ಗೆಟ್ ಟು ನೋ ಅಬೌಟ್ ದಿಸ್? ಸೊ ಅಟ್ ದ ಯುನೋ ಅಟ್ ದ ಔಟ್ ಸೆಟ್, ನನ್ ಆಫ್ ವಾಟ್ ಐ ಆರ್ ಗೋಯಿಂಗ್ ಟು ಸಿ ಟುಡೇ ಈಸ್ ಥಿಂಗ್ಸ್ ದಟ್ ಐ ಹ್ಯಾವ್ ಡಿಸ್ಕವರ್ಡ್ ಮೈ ಸೆಲ್ಫ್ ಪರ್ಸನಲಿ. ದೀಸ್ ಹ್ಯಾವ್ ಬೀನ್ ಡಿಸ್ಕವರ್ಡ್ ಓವರ್ 100 years ಬೈ ದ ಆರ್ಕಿಯಾಲಜಿ ಡಿಪಾರ್ಟ್ಮೆಂಟ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಸಮ್ ರಿಸರ್ಚರ್ಸ್. ಆಲ್ ಐ ಹ್ಯಾವ್ ಡನ್ ಇಸ್ ಸಿಂಥಸೈಸ್ ದಿಸ್ and developed a story. And that story is really unique, and that's what I'm going to be telling you today. Okay. So the area we are talking about most of the time will be centered around this building, which I'm sure everybody here knows, the BDA shopping complex. So around that, if we draw a 3-kilometer circle, this is the area of focus today. And this is a map of Bangalore. All the wards have been outlined on this. So you will see your own wards there. 151 Kormangla, 184 Ejipura, 173 Jaksandra. These are the corporation wards. This is how the structure, the city is organized. Very interestingly, it's also based on the villages. Bangalore is a collection of villages. You know, every one of these wards actually maps back to one or two villages. And if you can discover or unearth the story of the villages, you are discovering the story of the city itself. Okay, and so I'll start with this. I'll grow in a chronological order. Modalige Srinivagilu bagge maatadva. Srinivagilu, you know, a lot of people have heard this. Yesto, you know, ST tank bed anta karitare, Srinivagilu anta karitare, Srinivagilu anta karitare. All of these are the same place, which you know, Korma, behind Kormangla, in the large portions of it is in the defense areas today. So BDA shopping complex, from the BDA shopping complex, if you were to travel about 2.7 kilometers along Inner Ring Road towards Domlur, just before you hit the, you hit the defense areas there, and if you take a right inside into the defense land, about 3/4 of a kilometer inside, deep inside is one Shiva temple. Devasthana defense area galu olagi iddru sarvajanika public can go in. Yaru bekadru hogi alli nodabodu. Yaru eno tade illa, abhyantara illa, devasthanakke hogabodu, Ishwaran devasthanakke hogtini andre bidtare. Neevu enana hogiddidre alli olage devasthanad pakkadalli neevu idondu iga ee tara ondu kallanna neevu gamanisirabahudu. ಒಂದು ಕಟ್ಟೆ ಇದೆ, ಹಳಿ ಕಟ್ಟೆ ತರ ಒಂದು ಕಟ್ಟೆ ದೇವಸ್ಥಾನ ಎದುರಿಗೆ. ಆ ಕಟ್ಟೆ ಮೇಲೆ ಒಂದಷ್ಟು ನಾಗರ ಕಲ್ಲುಗಳು ಇವೆ. ಪಕ್ಕದಲ್ಲಿ ನಾನು ಕರ್ಸರ್ ತೋರಿಸ್ತೀನಿ ನೋಡಿ, ಇಲ್ಲಿ ನನ್ನ ಸ್ನೇಹಿತರು ರೇಣುಕಾ ಪ್ರಸಾದ್ ಅಂತ ನಿಂತಿರೋರು. ಇವೆಲ್ಲ ಫೋಟೋಗಳು ಸುಮಾರು ಒಂದು ವರ್ಷ ಹಳೆಯದು, ಹೋದ ವರ್ಷ ಮಾರ್ಚ್ ಅಲ್ಲಿ ತೆಗ್ದಿರೋವು. ಇಲ್ಲಿ ಒಂದು ಮಾರ್ಕ್ ಮಾಡ್ತಾ ಇದ್ದೀನಿ, ಅದು ಒಂದು ಕಲ್ಲು, ಮೂರ್ತಿ ವಿಗ್ರಹದ ಕಲ್ಲು, ದೇವ್ರ ಕಲ್ಲು ಅದು ಅಂತ ಕರೀತಾರೆ. ಹತ್ರದಿಂದ ನೋಡಿದ್ರೆ ನಿಮಗೆ ಈ ತರ ಕಾಣುತ್ತೆ. ಅಷ್ಟೊಂದು ತುಂಬಾ ಬಾಡೋಗಿರೋ ಕಲ್ಲು, ಅದರಲ್ಲಿ ನಿಮಗೆ ಜಾಸ್ತಿ ಏನು ನೋಡೋದಿಕ್ಕಾಗಲ್ಲ. ಇಲ್ಲಿ ಯಾರೋ ಒಬ್ರು ನಿಂತಿರಂಗಿದೆ, ಮೇಲೆ ಇಲ್ಲಿ ಯಾರೋ ಮೂರು ಜನ ಮೇಲ್ ಮೂರು ಜನ ಇದ್ದಂಗೆ ಇದ್ದಾರೆ. ಇವು ಏನಂದ್ರೆ, ಇದು ಮಿಲಿಟರಿ ಏರಿಯಾ ಅಂತ ಹೇಳಿದ್ನಲ್ಲ, ಅದು ಟ್ರೈನಿಂಗ್ ಏರಿಯಾ. ಈ ಕ್ಯಾಡೆಟ್ಸ್ ಎಲ್ಲ ಅಲ್ಲಿ ಟ್ರೈನಿಂಗಿಗೆ ಬರ್ತಾರೆ. ಅವ್ರಿಗೂ ಬಹಳ ಕುತೂಹಲ, ಏನಿದು, ಯಾರೋ ಬಂದು ನೋಡ್ತಾ ಇದಾರಲ್ಲ ಅಂತ ಹೇಳಿ ನಮ್ಮ ಹತ್ರ ಕೇಳ್ತಾ ಇದ್ರು. ಇದ್ರ ಬಗ್ಗೆನೂ ಹೇಳ್ತಾ ಇದ್ದೆ. ಇಲ್ಲಿ ನೀವು ನೋಡಿದ್ರೆ ಒಂದಷ್ಟು ಬಿಳಿ ಪಟ್ಟಿ, ಅದು ಗೋಧಿ ಹಿಟ್ಟು ಹಚ್ಚಿದೀವಿ, ಅಲ್ಲಿ ಅಕ್ಷರಗಳಿವೆ, ಕಲ್ಲು ಮೇಲೆ ಕೆತ್ತಿರ್ತಾರೆ. ಅವಕ್ಕೆ ಇನ್ಸ್ಕ್ರಿಪ್ಷನ್ಸ್ ಅಥವಾ ಶಾಸನದ ಕಲ್ಲುಗಳು ಅಂತ ಕರೆಯೋದು. ಕಲ್ಲು ಮೇಲೆ ಕೆತ್ತಿರ್ತಾರೆ, ಬರೆದಿರ್ತಾರೆ ಏನೋ ಒಂದು, ಯಾವುದೋ ಆ ಕಾಲದ ಭಾಷೆಗಳಲ್ಲಿ, ಕನ್ನಡದಲ್ಲಿ, ತಮಿಳಲ್ಲಿ, ತೆಲುಗುವಲ್ಲಿ, ಯಾವುದೋ ಒಂದು ಭಾಷೆಯಲ್ಲಿ. ಏನ್ ಬರೆದಿರ್ತಾರೆ ಅಂದ್ರೆ, ಒಂದು ಮುಖ್ಯವಾದ ಘಟನೆ, ಆ ಘಟನೆ ಎನ್ನ ಅಲ್ಲಿ ಅದರ ಬಗ್ಗೆ ವಿವರವಾಗಿ ಬರೆದಿರ್ತಾರೆ. ಘಟನೆ ಎಂಥದು ಯಾವುದು ಅಂದ್ರೆ, ಕೆರೆ ಕಟ್ಟಿದ್ದು, ದೇವಸ್ಥಾನ ಕಟ್ಟಿದ್ದು, ಊರು ಕಟ್ಟಿದ್ದು, ಅಥವಾ ಯಾರೋ ಒಬ್ರು ಮಾರ್ಟಿಯರ್ ಏನೋ ಒಂದು ಯುದ್ಧದಲ್ಲಿ ಸತ್ರು ಅಂದ್ರೆ ಅವ್ರ ನೆನಪಿಗಾಗಿ ಒಂದು ಸ್ಮಾರಕದ ಕಲ್ಲು ಹಾಕಿ ಅವರ ಬಗ್ಗೆ ಏನಾಯ್ತು ಅಂತ ಹೇಳಿ ಬರೆಯೋದು. ಇದನ್ನ ಇನ್ಸ್ಕ್ರಿಪ್ಷನ್ಸ್ ಅಥವಾ ಶಾಸನದ ಕಲ್ಲುಗಳು ಅಂತ ಹೇಳ್ತಾರೆ. ಈ ಪದ್ಧತಿ ಬಂದು ನಮ್ಮಲ್ಲಿ ಒಂದು ಸುಮಾರು ಈ ಪ್ರದೇಶದಲ್ಲಿ 1500 ವರ್ಷಗಳಿಂದಲೂ ಇದೆ. ಬೆಂಗಳೂರು ಪ್ರದೇಶದಲ್ಲಿ 5ನೇ ಶತಮಾನದಿಂದಲೂ ಕಲ್ಲು ಮೇಲೆ ಈ ರೀತಿ ಏನೋ ಒಂದು ಮುಖ್ಯವಾದ ಅಲ್ಲೊಂದು ಘಟನೆ ನಡೀತು ಅಂದ್ರೆ ಅದನ್ನ ಬರೆಯೋದು. ಕಲ್ಲು ಮೇಲೆ ಯಾಕೆ ಬರೆಯೋದು ಅಂದ್ರೆ, ಅದು ಶಾಶ್ವತವಾಗಿ ಬಹಳ ವರ್ಷಗಳು ಇರಬೇಕು ಅಂತ ಬರ್ದಿರ್ತಾರೆ. ಕೆಲವೊಸ್ತಿ ಅದ್ರ ಜೊತೆ ಒಂದು ಶಿಲ್ಪನೂ ಇರುತ್ತೆ, ಕೆಲವೊಸ್ತಿ ಇರೋದಿಲ್ಲ, ಬರೀ ಬರ್ದಿರ್ತಾರೆ. ಸಾಧಾರಣವಾಗಿ ನಾನು ಯೋಚನೆ ಮಾಡ್ಬೇಕು ಅಂದ್ರೆ ಇಟ್ ಇಸ್ ಜಸ್ಟ್ ಅ ಆರ್ಡಿನರಿ ಬೋರ್ಡ್ ಮೇಲೆ ನಾವು ಎಲ್ಲಾ ಕಡೆ ಫೌಂಡೇಶನ್ ಕಲ್ಲು ಹಾಕಲ್ವಾ, ಆತರ ಏನಾಗ್ತೀವೋ, ಅದು ಜಸ್ಟ್ ಅ ಬೋರ್ಡ್. ಬಟ್ ವ್ಯತ್ಯಾಸ ಏನು ಅಂದ್ರೆ, ಇವು ದೀಸ್ ಎಲ್ಲರೂ ಎಲ್ಲೆಲ್ಲಿ ಬೇಕಿದ್ರು ಹಾಕೋದಿಕ್ಕೆ ಸಾಧ್ಯ ಇರಲಿಲ್ಲ. ದೀಸ್ ಆರ್ ಎಸೆನ್ಷಿಯಲಿ ರಾಯಲ್ ಎಡಿಕ್ಟ್ಸ್, ರಾಜನ ಆಜ್ಞೆಯು ಇವೆಲ್ಲ. ಸೊ ರಾಜನ ಒಪ್ಪಿಗೆ ಇರಬೇಕು. ರಾಜ ಸುಮ್ಮನೆ ಕಂಡ್ಕೊಂಡಿದ್ದಕ್ಕೆಲ್ಲದಕ್ಕೂ ಬೇಕಿದ್ದಕ್ಕೆಲ್ಲ ಬರ್ಸೋದಕ್ಕೆ ಬಿಡ್ತಿರ್ಲಿಲ್ಲ. ನನ್ನ ಮಗು ಹುಡ್ದ ಬಾ ಅಂದ್ರೆ ಹಾಕ್ಸೋದಕ್ಕಲ್ಲ, ನನ್ನ ಮದುವೆ ಆಯ್ತು ಅಂದ್ರೆ ಹಾಕ್ಸೋದಕ್ಕಾಗಲ್ಲ, ಆ ಥರವಲ್ಲ. ಊರಿಗೆ ಅಥವಾ ರಾಜ್ಯಕ್ಕೆ ಏನೋ ಒಂದು ಬಹಳ ಮುಖ್ಯವಾಗಿ ಒಂದು ಏನೋ ಒಂದು ನಡೆದಿತ್ತು ಅಂದ್ರೆ, ಮುಖ್ಯವಾದ ಘಟನೆ ನಡೆದಿತ್ತು ಅಂದ್ರೆ ಅದಕ್ಕಾಗಿ ಅದನ್ನು ನೆನಪಿಗಾಗಿ ಅದರಲ್ಲಿ ಹಾಕಿಸ್ತಾ ಇದ್ರು. ಸೊ ದೀಸ್ ಆರ್ ವೆರಿ ಸ್ಪೆಷಲ್ ಈವೆಂಟ್ಸ್ ಅಂಡ್ ದೇ ರೆಕಾರ್ಡ್ ಸಮಥಿಂಗ್ ವಿಚ್ ಟ್ರಾನ್ಸ್ಪೈರ್ಡ್ ಇನ್ ದಟ್ ಪ್ಲೇಸ್ ಅಟ್ ದಟ್ ಪಾಯಿಂಟ್ ಇನ್ ಟೈಮ್. So all that we know as history today is essentially gathered from this. ನೀವು ಏನೇ ಓದಿದ್ರು ಸಾಧಾರಣವಾಗಿ 15ನೇ ಶತಮಾನದ ಆದ್ಮೇಲೆ ಪುಸ್ತಕಗಳು ಬಂದಿದ್ವು, ಅದಕ್ಕೂ ಮೊದಲಿನವೆಲ್ಲ ಈ ತರ ಶಾಸನದ ಕಲ್ಲುಗಳನ್ನ ಓದಿ ಅದ್ರ ಮೇಲೆ ಏನ್ ಬರ್ತಿದೆ ಅಂತ ಹೇಳಿ, ಇವು ಒಂದೇ ಅಲ್ಲ, ಸಾವಿರಾರು ಇವೆ, ಎಲ್ಲಾ ಕಡೆನೂ ಇವೆ. ಅವನ್ನ ಒಟ್ಟಾರೆ ಸಾರಾಂಶ ನೋಡಿ, ಓಹೋ ಈ ಕಾಲದಲ್ಲಿ ಈ ರಾಜ ಇದ್ದ, ಮತ್ತೆ ಈ ಊರುಗಳಿದ್ವು, ಇದು ಅವನ ರಾಜಧಾನಿ, ಈ ತರ ಏನೋ ಗುಂಪುಗಳು ತಂಡಗಳಿದ್ವು, ಈ ತರ ಈ ದೇವಸ್ಥಾನ ಕಟ್ಟಿದ ಈ ಕಾಲದಲ್ಲಿ, ಈ ಕೆರೆ ಕಟ್ಟಿದ ಈ ಕಾಲದಲ್ಲಿ ಅಂತ ಇತಿಹಾಸ ಅಂತ ನಾವು ಏನ್ ಕರಿತೀವಿ ನೋಡಿ, ಅದನ್ನ ಕಂಡಿಡಿದು ಪ್ರೈಮರಿ ಸೋರ್ಸ್ ಅಂತ ಹೇಳಿ, ಒರಿಜಿನಲ್ ಅಥೆಂಟಿಕ್ ಸೋರ್ಸ್ ಅಂತ ಹೇಳಿ ಈ ಶಾಸನ ಕಲ್ಲುಗಳ ಮೂಲಕನೇ ನಮಗೆ ಗೊತ್ತಿರೋದು ಇವತ್ತು. ಓಕೆ, ಸೊ ಮುಖ್ಯ ನಾನು ಮಾತಾಡೋದು ಎಲ್ಲಾನು ಇವತ್ತು ಶಾಸನದ ಆಧಾರವಾಗಿ ಇಟ್ಕೊಂಡು, ಆದ್ರೆ ಇದು ಶಾಸನ ಅಂತ ಯೋಚನೆ ಮಾಡಿಬಿಡಿ, ಇತಿಹಾಸ ನಿಮ್ಮೂರಿನ ಕಥೆ ಅಂತ ಯೋಚನೆ ಮಾಡಿದ್ರೆ ನಿಮ್ಗೆ ಅರ್ಥ ಆಗುತ್ತೆ. ಸೊ ಇದೊಂದು ಕ್ಲೋಸ್ಅಪ್ ಶ್ರೀನಿವಾಗಿಲ್ಲದು ಶಾಸನ ಕಲ್ಲದು. ಇದನ್ನ ಇಲ್ಲಿ ನೀವು ಗಮನಿಸಿದ್ರೆ ಮಧ್ಯದಲ್ಲಿ ಒಬ್ಬ ನಿಂತಿಯಾನೆ, ಅವನ ಈ ಸ್ವಲ್ಪ ಒಂದು ಈ ಬಲಗೈ ಬಂದು ಈ ಕಡೆ ಒಂದು ಕಡೆ ಚಾಚಿದೆ, ಇನ್ನೊಂದೇನೋ ಇದೆ, ಅವನ ತಲೆ ಮೇಲೆ ಒಂದು ಕೊಂಡಿದೆ, ಮತ್ತೆ ಇಲ್ಲಿ ಮೇಲೆ ಕೂತಿದ್ದಾನೆ ಅವನೇ, ಆ ಕಡೆ ಈ ಕಡೆ ಹೆಂಗಸರು ಯಾರೋ ಒಬ್ರು ಅವನ್ನ ಏನೋ ಏನೋ ಇದು ಮಾಡ್ತಾ ಇರಂಗೆ, ಉಪಚಾರ ಮಾಡ್ತಾ ಇರಂಗೆ ಇದೆ. ಇದು ಏನು ಅಂದ್ರೆ ವೀರಗಲ್ಲು ಅಂತ ಹೇಳಿ, ವೀರ ಸತ್ತಾಗ ಒಬ್ಬ ವೀರ ಏನೋ ಒಂದು ವೀರ ಕಾರ್ಯದಲ್ಲಿ ಸತ್ತಾಗ ಅವನ ನೆನಪಿಗಾಗಿ ಹಾಕ್ಸೋ ಕಲ್ಲಿದು. ದಿಸ್ ಇಸ್ ಅ ಸಿಂಪ್ಲಿ ಅ ಮಾರ್ಟಿಯರ್ ಸ್ಟೋನ್. ಇವತ್ ನಮ್ಮಲ್ಲಿ ಯಾರನೋ ಒಬ್ರು ಈ ತರ ಒಂದು
ಸ್ಮಾಲ್ ರಿಕ್ವೆಸ್ಟ್, ಇಫ್ ಯು ಕ್ಯಾನ್ ಥ್ರೋ ಇನ್ ಅ ಲಾಟ್ ಮೋರ್ ಇಂಗ್ಲಿಷ್ ಆಲ್ಸೋ ಇಟ್ ವಿಲ್ ಬಿ ಯೂಸ್ಫುಲ್ ಸರ್.
ಓಕೆ ಸರಿ,
ಯಾ
ಆಲ್ ರೈಟ್. ಸೋ ದಿಸ್ ಇಸ್ ಅ ಮೆಮೋರಿಯಲ್ ಸ್ಟೋನ್, ಮೆಮರಿ ಮೆಮೋರಿಯಲ್ ಸ್ಟೋನ್ ಇನ್ ಆನರ್ ಆಫ್ ಅ ವಾರಿಯರ್ ಆರ್ ಅ ವೀರ. ಅ ವಾರಿಯರ್ ಹ್ಯಾಸ್ ಡೈಡ್ ಇನ್ ಸಮ್ ಆಕ್ಟ್ ಅಂಡ್ ದಿಸ್ ಇಸ್ ಎಸೆನ್ಷಿಯಲಿ ಕಮಿಷನ್ ಇನ್ಸ್ಟಾಲ್ಡ್ ಇನ್ ಹಿಸ್ ಆನರ್. ಸೊ ಇನ್ ದಿಸ್ ಕೇಸ್ ಯು ವಿಲ್ ಸಿ ದ ವಾರಿಯರ್ ಹಿಯರ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಆನ್ ಟಾಪ್ ಇನ್ ದ ಟಾಪ್ ಪೋರ್ಷನ್ ಯು ವಿಲ್ ಸಿ ಅ ವಾರಿಯರ್ ಸೀಟೆಡ್ ಅಂಡ್ ದರ್ ಆರ್ ಟೂ ವುಮೆನ್ ಹೂ ಆರ್ ಸರ್ವಿಂಗ್ ಹಿಮ್. ದಿಸ್ ಇಸ್ ಎಸೆನ್ಷಿಯಲಿ ಅ ಸೀನ್ ಅ ಪಿಕ್ಟೋರಿಯಲ್ ಡೆಪಿಕ್ಷನ್ ಆಫ್ ಹಿಸ್ ರೀಚಿಂಗ್ ಹೆವೆನ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಅಪ್ಸರಾ ಸರ್ವಿಂಗ್ ಹಿಮ್ ದೇರ್. ಬಟ್ ಜಸ್ಟ್ ಬೈ ಲುಕಿಂಗ್ ಅಟ್ ದಿಸ್ ವಿ ಕೆನಾಟ್ ಟೆಲ್ ವಾಟ್ ಇಸ್ ದಿಸ್, ಹೂ ಇಸ್ ದಿಸ್ ಮ್ಯಾನ್, ವೆನ್ ವಾಸ್ ಇ ದೇರ್, ವಾಟ್ ಇಸ್ ಇಟ್ ದಟ್ ಹಿ ವಾಸ್ ಡೂಯಿಂಗ್ ವೆನ್ ಹಿ ಡೈಡ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಆಲ್ ಆಫ್ ದಟ್. ಹೌಎವರ್ ಇನ್ ದಿಸ್ ಪೋರ್ಷನ್ ಇಟ್ ಇಸ್ ಕಾರ್ಡ್ ಇನ್ ಕನ್ನಡ ಲೆಟರ್ಸ್ ಹೂ ಈಸ್ ವಾಟ್ ಇಟ್ ಈಸ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಆಲ್ ದಟ್ ಅಂಡ್ ದಿಸ್ ಇಸ್ ಅಟ್ ದ ಬಾಟಮ್ ದ ವೈಟ್ ಪೇಪರ್ ಥಿಂಗ್ ಯು ಸಿ ದಟ್ಸ್ ಕಾಲ್ಡ್ ಅನ್ ಎಸ್ಟಾಂಪೇಜ್. ಇಟ್ಸ್ ಎಸೆನ್ಷಿಯಲಿ ಅ ಇಂಪ್ರಿಂಟ್ ಆಫ್ ವಾಟ್ ಇಸ್ ರಿಟನ್ ದೇರ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಹಿಯರ್ ಯು ಕ್ಯಾನ್ ಸಿ ದ ರೈಟಿಂಗ್ ಅ ಲಿಟಲ್ ಬಿಟ್ ಬೆಟರ್. ನಾವು ಇಫ್ ಯು ಯುನೋ ಇಫ್ ಯು ಕ್ಯಾನ್ ಕನೆಕ್ಟ್ ವಿತ್ ದಿಸ್, ದಿಸ್ ಇಸ್ ಆಕ್ಚುಲಿ ಕನ್ನಡ ಫ್ರಮ್ ಅಬೌಟ್ 750 AD, ವಿಚ್ ಇಸ್ ಅಪ್ರಾಕ್ಸಿಮೇಟ್ಲಿ 1250 years ago. ದಿಸ್ ಇಸ್ ದ ಫಾರ್ಮ್ ಆಫ್ ಕನ್ನಡ. ಸೊ ಇದರ ಬರ್ದಿರೋದು ಐ ವಿಲ್ ರೀಡ್ ಇಟ್ ಕ್ವಿಕ್ಲಿ ಅಂಡ್ ಯು ನೋ ಸಿ ದೇರ್. ಎಡಗಡೆ ಅಲ್ಲಿ ಇರೋದು ಪೂರ್ವ ಹಳೆ ಕನ್ನಡ ಅಂತ, ಆನ್ ದ ಲೆಫ್ಟ್ ಇಸ್ ಪೂರ್ವ ಹಳೆ ಕನ್ನಡ, ಆನ್ ದ ರೈಟ್ ಇಸ್ ಮಾಡರ್ನ್ ಕನ್ನಡ, ಆಲ್ಸೋ ಆನ್ ದ ಟಾಪ್ ಇಸ್ ಇಂಗ್ಲಿಷ್, ದ ಸೇಮ್ ಥಿಂಗ್ ಟ್ರಾನ್ಸ್ಲಿಟರೇಟೆಡ್. ಯು ಕ್ಯಾನ್ ರೀಡ್ ಇಟ್ ಆಸ್ ವೆಲ್, ಮೇ ಬಿ ಅ ಲಿಟಲ್ ಡಿಫಿಕಲ್ಟ್ ಟು ರೀಡ್ ಬಟ್ ಐ ವಿಲ್ ಟೇಕ್ ಯು ಥ್ರೂ ಇಟ್ ಸೊ ಇಟ್ಸ್ ಈಸಿಯರ್ ಫಾರ್ ಯು ಟು ಅಂಡರ್ಸ್ಟ್ಯಾಂಡ್. ಸೊ ಇಟ್ಸ್ ಎ ಸ್ವಸ್ತಿ ಶ್ರೀ ಪಲ್ಸ್ ತೆರೆಯಮ್ಮ ಸಿ ಎನ್ ಎಲ್ ವಾಗಿಲ ತುರುವ ನಿಕ್ಕಿಸಿ ಸತ್ತು ಸುಗ್ಗಿಯಾದಂ ಅಂತ. ಸೊ ಬೇಸಿಕಲಿ ಇಟ್ಸ್ ಅ ಫೋರ್ ಲೈನ್. ವಾಟ್ ಇಟ್ಸ್ ಸೇಯಿಂಗ್ ಇಸ್ ಸ್ವಸ್ತಿ ಅಂದ್ರೆ ಇಟ್ಸ್ ಲೈಕ್ ಓಮ್ ಆರ್ ಶ್ರೀ, ಎಲ್ಲರಿಗೂ ಒಳ್ಳೇದಾಗ್ಲಿ ಅಂತ. ಇಟ್ ಇಸ್ ಅ ಗ್ರೀಟಿಂಗ್ ಅ ಸಲ್ಯೂಟೇಷನ್. ಶ್ರೀ ಪೆಲ್ಚ್ ತೆರೆಯಮ್ಮ, ಪೆಲ್ಚ್ ತೆರೆಯಮ್ಮ ಇಸ್ ಆಕ್ಚುಲಿ ಅ ನೇಮ್, ಇಟ್ಸ್ ಅ ಕಾಂಬಿನೇಷನ್. ಪೆಲ್ಚ್ ಅಂದ್ರೆ ಬ್ರೈಟ್ ಆರ್ ವೆರಿ ಇದಂತ, ಗ್ಲೋರಿ, ಲೆಟ್ಸ್ ಕನ್ಸಿಡರ್ ಲೈಟ್. ಎರೆಯಮ್ಮ ಇಸ್ ಅ ನೇಮ್. ಇನ್ ಹಳೆಗನ್ನಡದಲ್ಲಿ ಅರೌಂಡ್ 8th century ಟೈಮ್ ಅಮ್ಮ ವಾಸ್ ಆಕ್ಚುಲಿ ಆಲ್ಸೋ ಫಾದರ್, ಬಸ್ ಫಾದರ್. ಟುಡೇ ವಿ ಹ್ ಮಾರ್ಫ್ಡ್ ಇಟ್ ಇನ್ ಟು ಅಮ್ಮ ಇಸ್ ಮದರ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಅಪ್ಪ ಇಸ್ ಫಾದರ್, ಬಟ್ ಎರೆಯಮ್ಮ ಇಸ್ ಎರೆಯಪ್ಪ ಇಸ್ ವಾಟ್ ಇಟ್ ಬಿ ಟುಡೇ. ಎರೆಯಮ್ಮ ಆಫ್ ಸಿ ಎನ್ ಎಲ್ ವಾಗಿಲ, ದಿಸ್ ಇಸ್ ವೆರಿ ಕ್ರಿಟಿಕಲ್ ಅಂಡ್ ವೆರಿ ಇಂಪಾರ್ಟೆಂಟ್ ಟು ದಿಸ್ ಟಾಕ್ ಹಿಯರ್. ಸಿಯ ನೆಲ್ ವಾಗಿಲ್ ಅಂದ್ರೆ ಸಿಯ ಅಂದ್ರೆ ಸಿಹಿ, ಸ್ವೀಟ್. ನೆಲ್ ಇಸ್ ಪ್ಯಾಡಿ. ವಾಗಿಲು ಇಸ್ ಗೇಟ್, ಆಲ್ಸೋ ಯೂಸ್ಡ್ ಆಲ್ಟರ್ನೇಟಿವ್ಲಿ ಫಾರ್ ಪ್ಲೇಸ್. ಸೊ ದಿಸ್ ಇಸ್ ಸಿಹಿ ನೆಲ್ ಊರು ವಾಗಿಲು ಹಳ್ಳಿ ಸಮಥಿಂಗ್ ಲೈಕ್ ದಟ್, ವಿಚ್ ಇಸ್ ದಿ ಪ್ಲೇಸ್ ವೇರ್ ದೇ ವರ್ ಗ್ರೋಯಿಂಗ್ ಸ್ವೀಟ್ ರೈಸ್. ಓವರ್ 1250 years now, ಸಿಯ ನೆಲ್ ವಾಗಿಲ್ ಹ್ಯಾಸ್ ಮಾರ್ಫ್ ಟು ಸಿ ನೆಲ್ ವಾಗಿಲ್. Srinivagi. So the place that you know, driving past or walking past every day there, Srinivagilu, we know has was around in 750 AD because of this writing here. Okay. Then Turuva Nikkisi Sattu Sagyadam. So those days the wealth was cattle. You know, typically like today, a thief would come and steal jewelry or money or whatever. If you stole cattle, then you were stealing wealth in those days. So it was very common for somebody to come and raid a village, take away or drive away hundreds of cattle and, you know, steal or make money that way. So there have been there's some cattle thieves who have come, and this man, Yereyamma, in the process, has fought with them. And in the process, he has died. Okay? So that is Sattu is the same Sattu. Saggi Adam is Saggi is Swarga. Okay, so he reached heaven in this battle. Simple four-line inscription. It doesn't say, you know, if it's a pretty boring one because everybody dead can have some four lines written like this. But as Bangaloreans, if you are from Kormangala, if you are from Srinivagilu, what it is telling you is that this place, there was a person called Yereyamma who fought and died in a valorous act of that time in the place Srinivagilu. Think about this. A lot of people think that, you know, HSR, Kormangala are new layouts of Bangalore. This place existed for 1250 years at least. It's not new. By whose standards is it new? That is one. The second point is, if you look at the script there, where in the world can you have access to something that was written in your backyard 1300 years ago, unaltered in its original form? You can do it in Srinivagilu, you can do it in Kormangala. What is the language of the place 1300 years ago? You can go touch, see, feel, read about it. You just don't know the history of the place. That place is telling you the language that we speak today. And the richness of the language as well. The derivation of the name as well. So when I was there and I was talking to somebody, and I said, this Srinivagilu is derived from this, and I said, it's sweet rice. One of the old timers there, the natives, a farmer there, he said, ಸರ್ ಎಪ್ಪತ್ತನೇ ಇಸ್ವಿನಲ್ಲೂ ನಾವಿಲ್ಲಿ ದೊಡ್ಡ ಬೈರ ಅಂತ ಹೇಳಿ ಬಹಳ ಸ್ವೀಟ್ ಸಿಹಿಯಾದ ನೆಲ್ಲನ್ನು ಬೆಳೀತಾ ಇದ್ವಿ ಸರ್ ಬಿಕಾಸ್ ವಿ ವರ್ ಗ್ರೋಯಿಂಗ್ ಅ ಸ್ವೀಟ್ ವೆರೈಟಿ ಕಾಲ್ಡ್ ದೊಡ್ಡ ಬೈರ ಹಿಯರ್ ಇಟ್ಸ್ ದಿ ಗುಡ್ ಥಿಂಗ್ ಅಬೌಟ್ ಇಟ್ ಇಸ್ ಇಟ್ ಡಸಂಟ್ ರಿಕ್ವೈರ್ ಟು ಮಚ್ ವಾಟರ್ ಆಸ್ ವೆಲ್ ಇಫ್ ಯು ಹ್ಯಾವ್ ಟು ಗ್ರೋ ಪ್ಯಾಡಿ ಆಬ್ವಿಯಸ್ಲಿ ನೀಡ್ ಅ ವಾಟರ್ ಸೋರ್ಸ್ ಇಟ್ ಮಸ್ಟ್ ಬಿ ಅ ರಿವರ್ ದೇರ್ ಆರ್ ಇಟ್ ಮಸ್ಟ್ ಬಿ ಅ ಟ್ಯಾಂಕ್ ಆರ್ ಸಮಥಿಂಗ್ ಫಾರ್ ಫ್ಲಡಿಂಗ್ ಅಂಡ್ ಇರಿಗೇಷನ್ ಓಕೆ So the practice of growing sweet nel, sweet paddy, has been around there for 1300 years too. Okay, and so if you're growing paddy, there must be a lake. Which is that lake? The Srinivagilu tank bed, no? The tank we talk about. So in this four-liner, we know Srinivagilu tank is 1300 years old. It's not something that was around today. I don't believe it exists today, except maybe in some marshy patches somewhere there. It totally doesn't exist at all, and I'll show you where it was today. Okay, so this is where Srinivagilu Lake was, outlined in blue with dots. So this is around 6th main, a small area around it, and this was where the lake was. This is completely built over today. Old timers can tell you there was a marshy land lake and all of that. And today, I don't think there's any water stagnation or anybody can even tell you there was a lake there. Okay. Second one, Srinivagilu is not the only mention. There is a second mention of it in a stone that used to be originally in Domlur. Now it has been shifted. It is in the government museum on Kasturba Road. This is from 1297 AD. This is in Tamil language. And it mentions two places here. So you can see the writing here, which is much more clearer than in the previous case. Two places are mentioned, Kopi Palli and Chayanilayam. So what happened is in the Kannada to Tamil switching, some of the names were Tamilized. Like English, some names of the English have changed the pronunciation of some places. Same thing has happened in Tamil as well. Kopipalli is Kodi Halli. So if you're going on airport road, you know, it's right after the Domlur stop. NL Kodi Halli is what it is known as. Then the second one is Channel. So from 750 to 1300, there has been a continuity of existence of Srini Vagilu, and it goes on like that. Okay. So this is a donation. All that has happened is these two villages have been gifted to a temple. Unfortunately, the temple part has been erased here in Domlur. It's one of two temples, Chokanatha temple, which still exists, or there was also a Subramania temple until 1910, which was in ruins at that time, that's been erased. So the stone has been brought very likely from that ruined temple, Subramania temple, which is, you know, the flyover as you are coming from Ijipura side and climbing onto the Domlur flyover on the left side. There was this ruined temple. It is marked on old maps, 1900 maps, probably been brought from there as well. Okay. So the second thing that about Srini Vagilu. Now we'll move on. Just want to make a time check here, Badri. We're supposed to have started at 7. How long can I go on?
One second. Let me. Pritam sir, trying to unmute you. What's the time now?
It's 7:49.
8:15, 8:20.
All right. Thank you.
Thank you.
So the next one that I want to talk about and base the story of that region on is something called the Begur Nagataras Virgal. Begur is in the vicinity, but not within this 3.5 kilometer radius that we are talking about. Begur is in a little past Silk Board. There's a right turn, the first right on Osur Road, and that will take you towards Begur. If you go in there, you will see this magnificent temple. It's called the Begur Nageshwara, Nagreshwara, Panchalingeshwara, all kinds of, you know, many names are used for this. What you are staring at is essentially a 1100-year-old temple. This temple was built during around 900 AD. Okay. It's been modified. A lot of people have added to it, but the original is Ganga style. Gangas were the kings who were ruling at that time. And this is from 900 AD. What is extraordinary about this temple is probably for something as this is probably the only such old temple, I would say, in southern India, in as great a condition as this, a living temple where praying is people pray every day, and it's not damaged as well. Okay. Over here in this temple, there was this inscription stone. This is also a Virgal, but this is exquisite, very beautiful. It is not now in the Begur Nagareshwara temple, it is now in the Bangalore Museum. They shifted it to the museum. It's considered one of the most beautiful Virgals discovered anywhere so far. A lot of carving here. What it is showing is there's somebody here on an elephant, seated on an elephant with a spear in his hand, and there's someone else seated on a horse. In between is someone else with a shield and a sword. A lot of people surrounding. There are a lot of bodies around here. These are actually dead bodies. You'll see some of them have been speared. You'll see some with arms missing, legs missing, and all of that. So this is obviously a battle scene. Now, these people are fighting. There are many people who are dead around it. And on top here, you'll see a man seated. And there are some women dancing and seated who are serving him. So this is, as in the previous case, depiction of heaven. Somebody has died, gone to heaven, and in heaven, the Apsaras are serving them. Who these people are, what they were doing, why they were fighting, all of that is written here in the, on the top in Kannada from 900 AD. The previous was 750 AD, this one is 900 AD. In fact, it's not so hard. On a paucity of time, I won't take you through that, but it's some of the characters are very similar to what we use today. And this is a depiction of that same thing. Somebody has written it out in the old style and in the corresponding new letters for you to understand what's getting written. Just as an example, I pick one. For example, I say Sa here, Sa with a Dirga, you'll see the same Sa here. Some are similar, some are quite different. That aside, What's extraordinary about this from a historical perspective is what is highlighted in yellow here. All of these are place names. Now, these, what this is this is a Ganga prince, and this is a Rashtrakuta king. They were fighting in a place called Tumbepadi, which is, you know, close by, about 70 kilometers from here. And in that battle, this man called Nagatara, he died. He died by this elephant tusk piercing him. You never see that depiction of some of a hero being pierced by an arrow or felled or anything. You know, we never, even in modern day movies, we never show a hero falling down if he dies. You know, a hero will always fight 100 people and then, you know, they'll show him slowly rising to heaven or something like that, right? It's not considered good to show a hero has fallen. In this case, that's the same thing. The hero is shown fighting, but essentially he has died by the elephant tusk piercing him. And all that detail is given. So this man is Yareparsa, this man is called Nagatara, this is another person, so Mahendra. All that is written here. What has happened is, because he died, the king of the time, that time, he appointed another person as a successor to this man. This was a Begur chieftain. So appointed a successor, very likely it is not specified here, his son or somebody like that, to that post of the chieftain of Bangalore, and gifted him about 12 villages. It's the same, right? When you have a soldier dies in battle today, there is a Paramvir Chakra or whatever given. Along with it is also a monetary or some other, you know, site is given, or some compensation is given, right? It's exactly the same act. So in this case, 12 villages have been given as gift to the successor. And those villages are, I know, just, you know, Benpuru, Tovaguru and all that. So you can read them better here. So they are in English that you've added here. These 12 villages that are marked here: Bempuru, Tovaguru, Poinapuli Mangala, Kuttinadu, Nalluru, Komarangudu, Igluru and all that. Now, there are a few things which are very important for today's discussion. Bempuru is Beguru. So it existed then. Tovaguru is Toguru. On the way to Beguru, you will find Dottoguru, Toguru, right? That one. Puvinapuli Mangala is Ulimangala, which is there on a little further down. I think today it is in the Anekal zone. Komarangundu, critical to what we are talking today. In 900 AD, this was your Koramangala. Over time, it has changed. Komara is a name. Komaran Gundu. Gundu is actually in Kannada is a betta. Ale betta, you know, in Ale Kannada is a gudda or betta. Kumarana gudda is one understanding of this. Okay. Then Igaluru is Iblur. You know, in the border of HSR today, we have Iblur, right? So that is Iblur. Yelkunte, deep within, you know, buried in HSR today, is a village called Yelkunte. So Yelkunte existed in 900 AD. That's why, you know, it was gifted to this man called Nagatara, a successor of Nagatara, when he was killed in battle. Kudalu is Kudalu. Kudal is, by the way, also another word common in, many of these words are very common in Tamil, Telugu and Kannada. Kudal is confluence. Kudala Sangamadeva, Kudal, and then two rivers meet or whatever, you call that as confluence. In this case, there are no rivers there, but the logic or the understanding is it was the confluence or the intersection of trade routes. The north-south and the east-west trade routes passing through Bangalore or passing through the region essentially intersected at Kudal, which is also kind of, you know, happening even today. If you look at, you know, Sarjapur Road and, you know, the intersection of Sarjapur Road and Osu Road, you know, in that region, you will see a east-west, north-west, you know, north-south kind of a confluence happening as well. How old is Kormangala? Why did we say learn the 750 years, 1100 and 1200 years of history of Kormangala is because of this. Because Komaran Gundu, which is Koramangala, existed then. So the villages themselves together were called as Bempur Hanneridu. This is in Kannada. They tried to identify the locations there. What could have been Bempur Hanneridu? So this is Bempur at the center, Koramangala at the top. Then you have a whole lot of other places that are there that are being shown here. Okay. Bempur 12, if you just want to think about it, was like an assembly constituency equivalent of today. You know, we have so many wards, agglomeration of wards ending up as an assembly constituency, right? So these were all the places that constituted Bempur 12, which itself was a district in a country called Gangavadi 96,000. Which country did Kormangala belong to in 900 AD? Gangavadi. Which district did Kormangala or in any of those places, all of you here, whether you are from Yalkunte or Eglur or HSR, wherever, which country were all these a part of in 900 AD? Gangavadi. Which district were these areas a part of in 900 AD? Bempur 12. 12 because these are the 12 places there. Okay. So what we think of as today, we talk about wards and, you know, parliamentary constituencies, assembly constituencies, Karnataka, Bangalore, BBMP, etc. This has changed with over time. And this is one of those administrative units at that time. Eglur is a very interesting place because it finds mentions in many such inscriptions. I'm just not going through all of them, just calling out a few. In 1297, this has been renamed to something called a Veerabalala Chaturvedi Mangalam. Like Kormangala today, the Korman good over time has become Mangala, has been added as a Mangala as a Brahmin settlement, Agrahar or a Brahmin settlement. Now, Eglur was renamed during Veerabalala's time. Just like renaming is pretty common today, you know we want our favorite leader's name to be assigned to a road or a park or a ground. So was the case then. So they renamed Eglur to Veerabalala Chaturvedi Mangalam. There's an inscription which actually records this and says, we are now renaming it to that. Like most renamings, now, even in the past, the new name did not stick. So Eglur has stayed and Veerabalala Chaturvedi Mangalam has been forgotten. Okay. Now this is a critical piece. Madiwala as a story of, you know, in that place is extraordinary. A lot of information we can call out from there. Sorry, I don't know who's... Okay. So, the mud, ignore the scratch marks there. Yep, it's gone. Thank you. So, the Madiwala Someshwara temple, a lot of you may have seen, is quite common there. It's quite a popular temple. In fact, there's nothing extraordinary in terms of looks if you see it from the outside. However, if you go in, all over the temple, a lot of places, there is a lot of writing on that, inscriptions. Writing is how we deduce history, right? So it's telling us the story of that entire region in for quite a long period. It's exquisite, it's extraordinary for this in a reason. In this photo, two friends of mine, they are showing you the extents of one inscription. It's a 19-line, 1366 writing on stone. Okay. So there are like this all over the thing. We'll see 3-4 here, which gives you a story of a few things. This is on the rear part, and the bottom, this is called the Adhishtana. Usually in some of the older traditional temples, on the Adhishtana, you will see a lot of writing. In this case, it is from 1366 and it's Tamil. The whole inscription itself is extraordinary because it's almost about 100 feet long. Starts from here, goes all the way up, goes round, and then comes over to the front. That's how long this is. A lot of information in that, as you can gather. It is extraordinary because the previous slide I spoke about a Veerabalala Raja, right? The same Raja, he was a Hoysala king. He actually, during his time, a lot of temples were renovated or built. So we have a lot of information from that period. This one is very interesting for today's times because the way I like to call it or think about it is this is a very secular inscription of that time. So what they have done here is all temples need money, right? You know, if a temple has to function, there's rituals, there's priests, there's food, prasadam, there's all of that that needs cost money. And there is a funding mechanism needed for that. The funding mechanism of those days was very simple. Tax revenues, taxes were diverted to a temple by a king. So let's example say Kormangala, all the property tax of Kormangala, instead of being paid to BBMP, would be diverted to the Madiwala Someshwara temple for its operations and upkeep. That is how the temple got its money. That's how it's supposed to be doing today as well. Property tax is expected to be used on our roads, etc., etc., right? Developmental works within our thing. Similar, this was the thing. The difference is, and for such an exemption today, we would put it in a gazette and say this is a gazetted notification and that's when it is legal. Those days, they would write it on stone. That's the gazette of those days. And it would be signed off in the name of the king. That is the royal edict. It has to be signed off by the officer of the respective department or secretary or whatever today. That's how it would be done then. So all these writings that you see on temples are gazetted notifications of those years. In this one, what they have done is they have gifted some land to the temple. But when you give a gift, when you give an exemption, like when you give a property or whatever tax diversion there, there will be certain exemptions, right? So if Kormangala property tax is X and that is to be given away to somebody, you will exempt certain taxes from that. Exemptions could be, look, there is a charitable organization, an orphanage, a hospital, whatever. These are exempted from giving any donations to the temple, donations as in property taxes. The same thing here. So they given away, they have gifted away property revenue to the temple, but they have exempted three things. This is a Shiva temple, right? So they said any revenue from Vishnu temples, exempt. It's already a temple, so that temple should not be funding this. Will not, no, that's exempt. Jain temples, Jain basadis. Those days, Jainism was a big deal. Today, we hardly see any Jains anywhere, but Jains and Shaivites and Vaishnavites were almost in equal, or if not, you know, Jains were more dominant in the earlier years. So they said Jain basadis, Vishnu temples, and lastly, matas. Any matas which were already in that vicinity, they were exempt from giving money to this temple. So in that sense, the religious denominations of the time were Shaivites, Vaishnavites, Jains, and things like that. So in that sense, this is a secular inscription is why I like to call it. The difference though is, in this inscription, very rarely does a king address directly his subjects. Always the gift or the grant is done by a local businessman or a local chieftain or somebody like this. But in this case, the king himself is writing to his subjects and says, I, you know, Veerabalala, etc., 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 I'm ordering you people to do this. It's just like Prime Minister of India came on TV and said, you know, I'm ordering a lockdown. That doesn't happen every day. In this case too, that is exactly what happened. And the beauty of this is templatized. In this temple, they have gifted some villages and they've defined the boundaries and all that. Word for word, the same thing has been copied in Dumlur, Choknatha Swami temple. Gunjur in Whitefield, there was a Someshwara temple. In Kola, whatever. So it's like a template has been made and told, take out Madiwala Someshwara, put Dumlur Choknatha. Take out these four village names, put some of the four village names. So it is, it's very rare for inscriptions to be copied like that. But in this case, they have done that. And that's very nice. This is also in Tamil. I'll quickly move on. The second one, which is very interesting in 1365, why is this important? It mentions a lot of things. It mentions the place name Begur, which we already saw earlier. It mentions that Begur, there was a place called Begur Nadu, like we have heard of Yalanka Nadu. So this is the same district, taluk, district, state, or you know, or if you want to say district, state, country. So here, Vepur, the temple in those days was called the Tamrai Kerai temple. Madiwala is a new name. The original name was Tavrai Kerai, Tamrai Kerai in Tamil. Exactly the same. Tavrai Lotus Kerai Lake. So the Someshwara temple in Tavrai Kerai is how it was known. Over time, it has morphed and become Madiwala Someshwara, which is in Vepur Nadu, in Rajendra Swala Vala Nadu. So the state was Sola Valanadu, Rajana Sola Valanadu, and the if you want to think of it as the taluk, district, and state. Okay. So there was Veppur Nadu, which is the taluk, Rajendra Solavala Nadu, which is the district, Nigarila Sola Mandalam, which was Karnataka or the equivalent of a state, in Chola country. That is what it's saying here. What is extraordinary about this is, grant is, it is signed off. The witness is Hariappa. We call them Bukka Hariappa Raya, Bukka Raya, right? The founders of Vijayanagar Kingdom. That king, he was not the king at that time, he had given it his grandson, or the Bukkana's grandson was the king. He has stood witness. Every deed needs a witness, right? Legal deed needs witness. So every shasana, every gazetted notification needs a witness. Similarly, in this case, the king has stood witness. He has actually visited this temple in 1365. Everybody says Vijayanagar, you know, great kingdom, blah blah blah, all of that. Right in your neighborhood is a place where the founder of that empire has come, has gifted land, and says, I stand witness to this, and signed it off. You can feel it's quite an important place for that reason. Now, what is gifted here is gifted to, there's a person there, and I kind of mixed up the slides. I'm sorry, I'll come back here. Okay, I think I missed the slide. Okay. So the person it is being gifted to is a person called the Sri Rudra Sri Maheshwara Chitrameli. Now, a brilliant opportunity here to explain yourselves here. Today, a Rotary Club is an organization of diverse set of individuals, right? You could speak multiple languages, you could be from multiple regions, you could be multiple castes, all of the educational levels different, all of that, right? So in many ways, there were similar organizations earlier as well. The Chitrameli were a guild of agriculturists. This was a cross-caste agricultural guild. They were Brahmanas, Shudras, Kshatriyas, Vaishyas, all four who constituted this guild. However, these were a highly educated bunch of people. The definition of the guild is like that. You would get membership only if you met these criteria. You had to be very skilled in languages, including Sanskrit. You had to be very skilled in logic and judgment, because these people were kind of arbiters, local administrators, and all of that. In some ways, ward committees equivalents of today, at least in the theory. You know, today's ward committees are, I think, a different story. That aside, like a corporation ward committee is supposed to be a group of ward members, educated, diverse set of opinions, all of that. Similarly, the Chitrameli were that. So Chitrameli, a person of that guild has been gifted land. And that is what has been written here. There are many kind of things, like the panchayati system that we think about in the villages is a kind of evolution of these. So wherever in the temple, you know, typically in the courtyard, there would be a mantapa, or there would be a place where they would gather and discuss over laws, disputes, issues, and things like that. And that was typically called a Chitrameli Sava or mantapa. So please go to the temple, stand there, imagine yourself as there at that time, and think about all the discussions that could have transpired. This is democracy as we think about today, was in operation at that time. It was not true that all kings took all decisions and they were dynastic regimes, they gave the orders and all of that. Not true. They were governing organizations at all levels within the country. So the name that you saw, Veppur Nadu, Rajendra Solavala Nadu, and all of that, at various levels, there were governing systems and structures in place. The Chitrameli was that. And it's written over there in the Madiwala Someshwara temple. The name Madiwala itself, it's very commonly believed that Madiwala is a washerman community. There, by the tank there, the BTM tank there, there were dobis and You know, that's why this place is called name as Vadiwala. Generally, in other places which carry the name, this is true. But in this particular Madiwala, it is not true. It is not true because it's derived from the name Mada, you know, which is Mata in Tamil. There's a Tamil derivation. Vilagam is actually a Brahmin community. So that temple was obviously, there were temples there. Around the temples, traditionally, the Brahmins and the temple associated people only lived. The village was a little further away. So the place where, you know, the Mata was, or the Agrahara was, together, you know, the Mahadeva Vilagam over time has morphed to Madiwala. That's how the name has come about. Okay. So it came about later. So the earlier name of this place really was Tamarakere Someshwara. Now today it has born to Madiwala Someshwara. Why Madiwala? Because of this derivation. Now over here, you can see two friends, Venkateshan Perumal, who's pointing out to people over there something extraordinary. Every Bangalorean should and must know about this. What he was pointing out there is shown here. This is from 1248 AD. It was written on 3rd March 1248. We know this so well because the date is also written on the inscription as well. What is written there is in Tamil, Bengalur, which is the Tamilized form of Bengalur. If you can read Tamil, it's very similar to modern day Tamil. It is written as Bengalur there on the wall, which means in 1248, there was a Bengalur already in existence. Very, very different from what you think is the story of Bengaluru being founded in, 1537, etc., etc., etc. The place existed before. Proof of its existence is right there in your neighborhood. This is the second mention of Bengaluru, not the first. I'll speak about it later in a second. Okay. All it says is, and I'll skip this because of paucity of time. It says similarly that, you know, some lands are being gifted to the temple, and that those lands are below the big tank of Bengaluru is what it says. Okay. And a lot of other places are mentioned. Tavarekere was around at that time. We already know that. So, you know, we know the story of Tavarekere from this. How old is it? When did it exist? What form did it exist? And all of that. Also very interesting. From the BTM bus stand across the road, other side, diagonally, is something which is very rare in a lot of places. It's called a Huli Bete Veeragallu. Somebody fought with a tiger and died. In his memory, a Veeragallu was commissioned, a Martyr stone was commissioned. That is what here. This is on the footpath. This is only one of three in the city of Bangalore. Tigers roamed in your neighborhood around in the 13th, 14th century. Either the tiger turned man-eater or was stealing cattle or something, or maybe just for fun, you know, the people decide to hunt it down. In the process, one man died. And, you know, they honored him with this stone here. This was lying on a site, vacant site behind. I think this is an Airtel office or this is a hotel. It was lying in this site here in the building and it was going to be broken. This man here, his name is Mani. He's a idli, you know, dosa. He sells food cart. He has a food cart there. He sells by the roadside. So they were worshipping it. You know, these people worshipped that. And he saw that it could be broken. So he kept it, brought it over into the road and his place built it and saved it. Extraordinary heritage. And it's been done by someone who has no clue what it is and the story it tells us. But they don't look to, it needs cleaning, etc., etc. But that aside, it's been saved by a uneducated, not a native. This man comes from Dharmapuri or somewhere like that. But his feeling and, you know, affinity for the place is so high. He decided to do something and he has saved it. I'll rush past this, and the question is, okay, how old is Agara Lake? Similarly, from an inscription, we know that Agara Lake must have been in existence in 870 AD. Iblur, Odeya, the chieftain of Iblur, he actually had two sluice gates installed to the temple, to the tank, I'm sorry. Sluice gates because if they're growing wheat or paddy or whatever, obviously you need to control the water. Outlets had sluice gates, and for building those, fixing those, you needed the money, and that's what was commissioned. and he built something called the Eastern Tank. So Belandur and Agara lakes are the two lakes mentioned here that existed in 870 AD. The Eastern Tank was built, which was the Iblur Lake. You know, today if you're going up from the flyover from the Silk Road side towards Krishnapuram side, just before Iblur on the flyover left side is a Salarpuriya something. Behind that is the lake. It was built in 870 AD. Agara and Belandur already existed. Okay. I'll skip all this and I'll come to Jaksandra. Jaksandra is very interesting. The Sandras, Chakka Sandra, Bomma Sandra, Channa Sandra, Allala Sandra, any Sandra you see is actually a modification or a corruption of Samudra. Samudra was an exaggerated term for a lake. So if there's a big lake, they said like a Samudra, right? So that itself was turned into a name. Jakka was a person. Jakka Sandra. Jakka Samudra became Jakka Sandra. It is mentioned in an inscription from 1495. So where is this Jakka Samudra? There's no lake around there. If you know that, it was there. If you look at 1905 revenue maps, most lakes mentioned in inscriptions existed in the 1900s. The revenue map of Jaksandra shows a lake, and that is what I outlined here. Surprisingly, it's turned into a park today. This is called the Veera Yodhara Park, just behind the BDA complex. Some of you probably go there for walking as well. You're walking on the bed of a lake that existed in 1495, was 500 years old. Okay, and the most well-known Samadhi, there's a Samadhi in Kormangala everybody talks about. Unfortunately, this is not substantiable through any historical facts. All these other things that I've told you are historical facts. This is folklore. Typically, it could be that somebody made it up, exaggerated it, or it could have been real or whatever. But folklore is not history in the true sense. There's no evidence to substantiate it. Neither is there evidence to say it is wrong. So the Kempe Gowda's daughter-in-law story and the Samadhi there, it's, I would say, not historical, more romanticized. So if you really are from that region and you have a claim to make about the historicity of the place, I'd say don't talk about this, talk about all the other wonderful things I spoke about earlier. Okay? Look at this a little differently. The story of any place in our country is the story of its villages. We hear the story of kings. We read the story of kings. We don't read the story of ordinary people or villages. The truth is, the story of any place is the composite story of villages in there. And that's all I was trying to tell you. So today when you talk about Bangalore, you tend to think Bangalore was built, the Kote, Pete and all that. Not true. I've been speaking to you about, almost for 50 minutes now, which is a story of your region, your neighborhood. Okay. So in summary, I spoke about a few things here. Spoke about Srinivagilu being from 8th century, Kormangala being from 900 AD, Tavarekere from 1248, Agara from 870, Jaksandra, Begur, whatever. Now, a little bit higher level, and I'll skip all this. How old is Bangalore then? Real answer is, which part of Bangalore are you talking about? If I'm Kormangala, I'll say, look, I'm from 750 AD. That's a part of Bangalore. That's true about Bangalore. Okay. In the name itself, in the same Begur Nageshwara temple I spoke about, is a similar inscription from about 890 AD. This is the first written record of the name Bengaluru. You can read it here on the pink on the fourth line. Bengaluru is written in 890 AD. Place existed then. Second evidence, and this is now installed in a nice gazebo and pedestals with placards and all that. And it's a good thing to go see when you see that temple. Second evidence was the Tamil inscription, Bengaluru in it from 1248. Just not two, there are three more before the 16th century in inscriptions as well as in literature. And the third one is from 1434 in copper and plate inscriptions from Gumlapura. They're now in Bangalore University. There's a fourth one in Telugu literature called Shivatattva Chintamani by Lakkanna Dandesha, who was a general, very famous man, Vijayanagar chieftain, who went and conquered Ceylon as well. And then, you know, we have a fifth one, again from 1480. Point I would want you to note, two things. Mentions of Bangalore five times before 1537, supposedly the place was founded. Second, three different languages. First one was in Kannada, second one is in Tamil, third one is in Telugu. This is the very fabric of this place for 1,000 years at least. You know, I was surprised not to hear Telugu and Tamil being spoken earlier before we started. But in Bangalore, anybody, everybody, natively, I'm not talking about migrants or recent migrants, speaks three languages. Kannada, Tamil and Telugu. Any place interior you go to, that is what you'll hear. Bangalorians have no problems with languages. We speak Kannada, Tamil, Telugu in our family, in our street, wherever. We also learn, you know, Hindi and English in schools and all that. So the cosmopolitan nature of the city is grounded in the past. Why is it different from, say, a Delhi or a Madras? Not a Madras. Madras is also bilingual. You know, some of these other places is because for 1,000 years we have used these languages, whatever be the causes. Okay. Now, some of you probably may be from other localities. So you'll be question will be, how old is my locality? If I'm from Vijayanagar, Rajajanagar, some other place. This map shows you color-coded. Each of the wards is what I'm showing you color-coded there, which is also the villages. Starts from 500 AD and I stop at 1600 AD. Dark brown is 500 AD, which is Begur. Begur existed in 15517 AD. We have that in inscriptions. All around the city, you are seeing different wards have different ages. When I'm saying ages, I'm saying the first mention of the name of that place in an inscription from that time. I showed you one for Srinivagalu from 750 AD, right? So if Srinivagalu were a ward, it is not. I would have color-coded it as violet or something. So ask yourself now, how old is the city? How old is your locality is what you have to ask. But I'll say it's at least 1500 years old. Okay? I'll take five more minutes and wrap this up. This is about the ward. Now you can ask, okay, I want to find out where it is as well. These maps are online. These are Google Maps. Please, you can search for inscription stones of Bangalore Google Maps and you'll get it. Or scan this QR code, you'll get it. Go to this and then you can identify it. In fact, online you can do more. You can click on that inscription stone and you'll get a route map. You can use it for Google directions and go and see it yourself. And the Google Map shows you the text of the inscription, audio, video. Everything is there and you can, you know, it's kind of a self tour for you. Yep. So this is a different way of representation of the same thing. Localities of Bangalore in a color cloud. In the brackets is the age when it is first mentioned and the size of the font is how old it is. So you'll say I mentioned, yes, some names are modified over time. So I've said Yalkunte HSR 900 AD, Begur 517 AD. Pinya, that's Dot Bidarkalu there, 750 AD. Hebbal, 750 AD. Domlur, 1100 AD. Now, please tell me, is Bangalore a new city? Kind of laughable. There is no city anywhere in the country or in the world where you can draw up a map like this and with evidence say, look, Rajajinagar was not set up when Rajaji came here and built it. In Rajajinagar is a place called Juganalli, which is ESI Rajajinagar third block, which existed in 1386. That's where I come from, by the way. So, you know, that's the way I would think about as the story of the city. Similarly, the story of the lakes. Today, you know, everybody is wooing about lakes. Oh, Sampambadi is not there. Dharmambudi is not there. This lake is filled over. That's not true. Four or five lakes have been lost. In this list, there are 43 lakes. The oldest lake is Hebbal Lake, 800 AD. Very much there. Agara Belandur, about the same. Next time you stare at that lake when you're passing by in Agara, please think about this. 870 AD, the lake existed. What's a big deal? If you are an Agara resident, 8 70 AD is approximately 38 generations of people there lived off this lake until we got water, piped water supply into our homes. Residents of Agara used the Agara lake water for drinking, for cooking, for agriculture. If people are living in that vicinity, it is thanks to the water of this lake. That's how you need to revere. Bangalore has come about to be the global capital, a global capital today, because these lakes have been the sustenance that people have lived off. We need to be grateful. We need to celebrate this. We need to celebrate this for these reasons, that for 35 generations of evolution has resulted in the city being what this is. Okay, so I'll skip this. This is the prehistoric part. What I told you was history. History means something is documented, written in language. Prehistoric is carvings, paintings, and all that on rock. We have these as well. The oldest goes back to about, these are paintings I'm showing you. They are undateable clearly between 500 to 1000 BC. And I heard somebody saying Sarjapur Road, Kaneli, or you know, Kayakondanalli or somewhere. This was in Dodkaneli near that Gare International School, a big boulder. 10 years ago, it was blasted for construction and we destroyed it. But these are photos. These are supposed to be about 3,000 years old. Signs of human habitation 3,000 years ago. You can see a man riding what looks like a horse. You can see on the left side here, you'll see people dancing. There's a man dragging a cow and there's a man riding a horse. Signs of civilization 3,000 years ago in the vicinity of where we are, most of you are seated today. Okay, I'll skip this and move on. Even older, and I'll skip all this for paucity of time. The other big thing people talk about Bangalore today. Oh, this is a global city. People come from all over the world. We service the world. We've not been doing it today. We've been doing it for a long time. These are coins that were found when they were building the HAL airport runway in the same vicinity, close to where we are on. These coins are Roman coins from about 60 BC to 30 AD, 2,000-year-old coins. They found in HAL airport, they found near Yeshwanthpur railway station, found near Jalali and Belandur. Four places, significant number of coins. I think this one was about 250 coins. You don't find a lot of coins like this because just like that, must have been trade from here, or either Roman traders came here or something like that. International trade has been something in Bangalore, not today, but 2,000 years ago as well. So it's not a global capital. I wouldn't call it a capital those then. There were global relationships even then. Okay, I'll skip all this paucity of time. Now, the point that Badri spoke about, we do conservation. Most of these inscription stones are unknown. I don't know how many of you would have seen it. They're lying at the edge of a road. They may be in somebody's site. They may be lying in a temple. A lot of them are getting destroyed. Priceless. Because they don't understand and we destroy them. Very often the road is being expanded and they break the stone and use it for jelly there. Or same with a temple reconstruction project or a house building project. This one was sitting in a gutter. And white topping, you know, whatever was going on, pothole filling. They were going to fill up the, you can see this here, they were going to fill up this ditch with four stones. One of them is from 750 AD. This is Kannada writing. Oldest writing in this city. Purvalai Kannada. Kannada. It mentions, like I mentioned other places, it mentions Hebbal. Sitting in a gutter, it would have been destroyed. This is so rare that in the entire Karnataka region, there are only, this was sample number 63 of Kannada ever. If you ask and go back in time and show me pieces of written Kannada, this is the 63rd sample that was available. Of the 63rd, my guess is about 40 have been destroyed. So existing maybe about 21. This was sitting in a gutter. He said, this is not the respect dignity it deserves. It must be put on something much as magnificent. That magnificent structure was this mantapa, which is a Ganga style mantapa. Ganga because it was a period of the time. It was completed earlier this year and this is how it looks today. the inscription stone, the oldest inscription, the oldest sign of literacy in the city of Bangalore is that stone. All of you are literate, right? I guess whatever you are is today because you are literate. So oldest sign of literacy was lying in a gutter. And we thought it shouldn't be put on any ordinary place, and we put it up on a mantapa like this. Extraordinary mantapa. And we said, this is not something any one of us should be funding, organization or an individual. It should be citizens of Bangalore who get together and do this. So about 350 individuals and six companies got together and funded the cost, the construction of this stone mantapa. Exquisite, extraordinary, probably the only one of this style which has been built after 1,000 years. This is in Hebbal. Okay, I'll skip this. And almost inevitably, if there were an interactive session, the question would have been, okay, very interesting, what do I do? Okay, a lot of things, a lot of people have done a lot of things. Whatever is your skill, whatever makes you comfortable, you can participate in different ways. People who write stories, we have two sisters who have written children's short stories based on these inscriptions. Okay, inspired by the hero, fictionalizing that and building a short story. It's now in being serialized in Sudha and Mayura, and it's a big hit. Those short stories are being enacted in schools and colleges and places like that. Photographers have gone around and photographed this. Documentaries have been made. People have built have gifted a lot of things for popularizing this. This is a bookmark which is of that Bangalore Virgal. On one side, the text of the inscription is there, whatever. These are giveaways in bookstores and places like this. This is being gifted away for people to use. And many ways. Some people have said, look, we don't want to do all that. We'd like to give you money to use for the projects. That is how the mantapa was built. That is also being done. Also, some of these inscription stones are still in that undignified state in many places. So we want support of local people to kind of conserve them and save them. In this case, my request to you all is that Srinivagalu inscription that we saw at the very beginning, and I'll go back to that, is this one is half buried. 20 years ago, it was fully exposed. Over time, they raised the cutte and it's now half buried. Something which is as incredible as this, 1200-year-old writing with the name Srinivagalu should need better, should be showcased better. I'll say, if you can help us have this lifted up, put it up on a nice platform and a board alongside, I think that will be a great thing, to participate from your sides. What will it take? Maybe coordinate with these temple authorities, and nobody has an issue. Somebody has to just step up and say, look, this is what it is. Can you help us? We'll do it. Either at your cost, my cost, whatever cost. Work through that. We have all the backward things required for this. How safely to take it out. The departments that have to be coordinated, whether it's BBMP or whether it's archaeology department, all of those are behind the scenes. We know that very well. But local coordination, if you want to work with the temple authorities, the trust, the military people and all that, and say, look, let's lift it and put it up. I think it'll be a fantastic effort and it'll be a worthwhile participation from your side as well. So with that, I'll leave you with this. Where can I find more information? We are very active on social media. You can find us in the group Inscription Stones of Bangalore on Facebook. Same at Twitter, Inscription BLR. Every day something is being discussed extensively on Facebook. You can join us there and monitor there. Me as well, pretty simple. My number is there. You can call me up anytime, write to me or whatever, and we'll be happy to coordinate with you. Okay. So I know I took a little bit more time than you expected as well. So I'll stop the presentation now and look at the chat thing. If there's any questions, or if you can unmute and ask as well, that'll be wonderful.
Uday, thank you very much. Very interesting journey. We are definitely running short of time, but I see two questions there. If you can give a two-word answer for each of those, I'd appreciate that.
Which one?
One question is about Agra Lake. You did mention something, but if you can add a little bit about Agra Lake. Another question by our HSR president is a question about Majestic area. What is the history? Was there any lake there? You can give a quick answer and then hand it over, and then hand it over to our president, Rotarian Pritam.
Okay, great. Thank you. So Agra Lake, like I mentioned, it is from 870 AD, approximately 1200 years old today. Now, Agra and Belandur are both mentioned simultaneously in the same thing, in the same inscription. Agra as a place, though, is not that old. Agra, the village itself, is probably Vijayanagar times, at most about 500, 600 years old. In those days, the prominent location was Iblur. So these lakes, Agra, Belandur, and Iblur, they are all a part of the Iblur Nadu. So distinguish between the lake and the place in this case, as old as that. And I don't know what else I can say about it, but that's about that. I can need a lot more explanation, but I'll say that's the vintage of the lake. The second was about the Majestic area. Right. So, you know, very simply, everybody's mind keeps going back to this Chikpete, Badapete, Majestic and all that. It's very new by the, you know, by what I've shown to you today. Those are the newer localities of Bangalore, where the Majestic bus stand was a lake called the Dharmambudi Lake. It is a very recent lake. Probably about 300, 400 years old at most. Compared to what I'm talking about, Jaksandra was, lake was 600 years old, Agra Lake is 1200 years old, Hebbal is 1300 years old. Please remember the word I am missing out here is at least. I'm saying it is at least 800 years old because that's the first mention, evidence we have. Probably existed even much before that. Dharmambudi, there is nothing in the inscriptions typically stopped around 1600. Because books took over. Dharmambudi, Kempambudi, Sampangi, the most commonly spoken about mentioned lakes are very recent lakes. Nothing extraordinary about them from a historical perspective or a vintage perspective. Yeah, and that is the focus of my story itself here today. Please stop thinking Bangalore is new. The story started with Kempegowda. Absolutely not. The story goes back millenniums before that. There's a rich story before that, and what I've tried to give you today is a flavor of that.
Thank you, Uday. Thank you very much. I will now hand over to President Rotarian Pritam. Uday, we have a request from some of our participants. If you can stay on a little longer, and after a couple of other conversations that we need to have, if you can address a few more questions, I'm sure everybody, there are a lot of questions out there.
Yeah. I'm sitting at home, fine, comfortable, so I can stay as long as you want.
No traffic to worry about.
Yeah. Nothing to worry about.
Okay. Yeah. I'll unmute everybody and over to you, Pritam sir.
Thank you once again, Uday. It is a wonderful talk. And then you deserve a standing ovation. It's going to be a personal meeting. Certainly would have put up a standing ovation. And one more thing is that, you know, it's because we were all sitting at home and then we had a patience to listen to the stories behind it. Whether it could be HSR or Sinu. I think Frank is staying in Estipet. So he started from Estipet area. And so when the today's talk was started from Estipet area, so you know that how old is the Estipet and then Sinuaglu. Thank you so much, Uday. I think you needed some more time. Probably we can have one more session, a joint meeting like this. It's about connecting the lakes. You know, it says that all these lakes are interconnected. So we want to listen to that more. Probably another session we can have very soon.
Thank you. That was wonderful, Rotarian Uday. Wonderful. We never knew that kind of an history, and the way you explained was awesome. It was absolutely, I was thinking that, oh my God, history means we are getting boring. But not even a single point I missed it. It was an awesome. Thank you so much for that knowledge. It is just a myth or just an understanding. I just want to have a question about two, as you already cleared it. This Bendakaluru king came in the horse and woman gave a Bendakaluru and became a Bengaluru. That is, now I understood that is not the story. We have friends outside Bangalore who tell, and I tell this story. Now I have to rework the story back that we are not from that kings.
So I'll make one point on that. The Bendakaluru story was actually asked to be discarded or rubbished in 1915 by the head of Mysore Archaeological Department at that time, by a man by name R. Narasimhachar. In 1915, he wrote in an official Mysore Archaeological Report, "Please stop telling this Bendakaluru story." Okay, it's 115 years and we still keep saying that.
That is recorded more. But again, another question is about this Madiwala. Yeah. So again, I was looking at, didn't do much research on the history, but it was Nachideva Madiwala is what that has come, history is what been told. Yeah. And it is renamed as Nachideva Madiwala. That is not correct, right?
No, it is not correct. It is not correct for this place. Generally, there are many Madiwalas. In the old Mysore region, you will find a lot of Madiwalas. In many of those places, that story that you are talking about, Machideva or Gobis and all that, that is correct. However, in this
case, it's not as nice in the business.
It is not true.
Can you mute yourself if you are not speaking? Some of us are rotated. Thank you very much.
Yeah. So in this particular incident, in this particular Madiwala, that is not true. Okay. So please don't go around saying this for every Madiwala everywhere. You'll be in trouble.
Okay. Next question from Sridhar.
Yeah, I'm sorry.
Sridhar, are you there?
I'm sorry. I just had.
Oh, sorry. One sorry. Point. Yeah. Yeah. Please.
Yeah. Just one point. There are other such examples. Not this is not the only one. In Kolar also there is another Madiwala. Which is exactly the same derivation of a Mata and a Agra, the Mahadeva Vilagam. No? So, in three instances, actually, that derivation is of Machideva, Dobis is not correct. Now, I'll add one point because you raised two very similar questions. One was Madiwala and the Bendakaluru story. A lot of folklore is passed off as history. There's a big difference. History is evidence-based, fact-based. Folklore is word of mouth. Now, this meeting will now be discussed outside with 20 other people in 20 different ways. You liked it, you said you had a great meeting. Somebody else hated it, they'll say, what a waste of time. Both of which may be true, okay? But that's folklore and that's not evidence-based. If I put a poll here and I said, you give me a score, or what you think about it, and all of you scored, let's say, 70 out of 100, then I can claim it was a first class based on evidence. There's a two, that's history and folklore difference. Okay, thank you.
Thank you. Sridhar, are you there? Can you go ahead?
My video. Hello?
Yeah.
Yeah, at least someone can see my face. Uday can see my face. Otherwise, I'm a faceless person.
Okay. Yes.
Someone has frozen my video.
Okay.
I think Badri. Okay.
I'm asking. Yeah, you're there.
Hi, Uday. It was a very entertaining, nice, interesting talk. And as Suresh had mentioned, even I had the wrong impression that Bangalore was just about 100 years or 200 years old, and that's what our history books had said. Now my question is, the current syllabus, is it revamped to incorporate whatever you said, or still it's going to be in talks like this that we get to know the real Bangalore? Because it's important that the curriculum also gets revamped and they know the true story.
So it's a it's a dream, sir. I wish we can work this into our textbooks. But working something into textbooks takes a very long time. there's a bureaucratic process, one. Also, the difference is the philosophy. The reason it is not in textbooks today is because we start a different end of history. Our perception of history is also wrong or different. A historian's view to history is the story of dynasties, kings. Okay. It is not a story of a place. Even a story of a place becomes, it's turned into a story of a king. So all our history books, not just textbooks, even other books are written in that manner. So we know, which is why if you ask any child today, have you heard of Baidu Nagatara? I'll say, what Nagatara? I'm all rubbish. Alexander the Great, yes, sir. Now, never in our life we will go to the places where Alexander went or Alexander was, whatever. We know the dates, we know Porus, we know this, we know all of that story. But the man who is responsible for giving us the name of the city, we won't know. Because we start at the big and the far away and the abstracted and all of that. So to change this mindset, even in the academic world, is not easy. And that was the reason I put up a slide which was extracted from a book. That book was written in 1924, and that said the story of India's villages. They don't mention, they don't care about dynasties, kings, and all that. They said the story of India is the story of its villages. And to change this mindset is very hard. I wish in my lifetime I'll see it, but I seriously don't think it'll happen. So the alternate way of doing it is through forums. We do a lot of events with schools, in colleges extensively, and we say out of your curriculum there is this interesting thing, and these kind of opportunities anywhere and everywhere, every opportunity we love to go and talk, present, we do exhibitions and all of that. But formal education system will take time. It won't happen today. I wish I could do it. Maybe I'll have to become the chief minister or education minister or something, or one of you. It won't happen.
What is stopping is it the lack of conviction, or there must be something which is stopping it, because if you have everything which is has a sound base, why shouldn't the education ministry not incorporate what you're saying?
Change takes time, because we may have everything handy, but for people to adapt it, accept it, and consider it, it's a very long-drawn process. I've had discussions with some education department associated people. I even made a presentation to some of the ministers, the tourism minister and all that. It is a slow process of hacking away and getting things done. Maybe somebody significant, somebody with the authority and the power can make it happen. It won't happen so quickly.
The other question I had is, in one of the inscriptions in Madiwala or Someshwara temple, a date had been written, and it was, if I recall, 3rd March 1248.
Correct.
Right?
Correct.
But at that point, there was no Christian calendar. Could you guess? It doesn't look genuine. That's my first impression.
Right. It's a wonderful question. And thank you very much for asking. In typically, my talks are rarely I do a talk. We do this in Madiwala itself. And the first thing that we point out is what you asked just now. I'm taking out the document and reading it out to you. But anyway, I'll skip that. We didn't have a Christian calendar system perfect. But we had a very, very precise, exhaustive calendar system, which multiple calendar systems called the Shaka or the Saka calendar system. Even today, if you take out your Panchanga, all of us would have Panchangas at home, right? You will see some Samvatsara, some Masa, some Kshatra, some Paksha, and some Tithi. I got the order wrong, but that's what it is. You have a name for a year. You have a numerical number for a year. 1248, how do I know it is? The Shaka system starts at 78 of the Christian calendar system. in numbers in Tamil on that inscription, 1248 minus 78, whatever is that number, is written. It says this year, which corresponded to this Samvatsara. If you give me a second, I'll read it out. I'll read it out and make it more realistic for you rather than leave it thinking. Here you go. Okay, I'm reading. I don't know if you know Tamil, but if you can, it'll be so much more fun. Calendar system. When it was Plavanga Samvatsara, Chitrai month, Purva Pakshate, Krishna Paksha, or the second fortnight, Chatur, which is the fourth day, you can easily convert this into the Christian calendar system. That's all I have done. And I have changed it to 3rd March 1248. If I had put what I had written there, you wouldn't
have. We don't understand.
You wouldn't have noticed.
Okay. Definitely you will not understand.
Okay. In many cases, they even write the period of the day. Our days also have periods, right? They write that as well. Now, I hope I answered, but I'll just throw in one more information which you didn't ask. This is very significant for what sir said before. We are a tantric city, right? We are a science and technology city. Many of these donations were done on days of eclipses, solar eclipse and lunar eclipses, because the jungle belief was gifting during the day of an eclipse gained you more punya. Okay, it's like on a birthday we give, or somebody's death anniversary we'll go give gift or something like that. So the significance was, on the solar eclipse day, you go gift somebody something. You, whatever punya you would attract normally, you would attract more here. So days of eclipses are favorite days for donations. Okay. How is this significant? So this is not in Kodige Halli. It is on 3rd August 1431. They say on the day of a solar eclipse in 3rd August 1431, the day of a solar eclipse, we are gifting this village to somebody. You can do two things today. Actually, NASA produces something called the Atlas of Eclipses, which is all the historic eclipses in the last 5,000 years. Eclipses change by region. If there's eclipse today, it's not happening somewhere else. Please open that atlas. It's free on the web. Check if 4th August 1431, there was an solar eclipse in Bangalore. It did. What does it say? Solar eclipses are, you can know about an eclipse in two ways. One is, you can look at the sun or the moon, and if it is covered, then you can guess there's an eclipse happening. But like today, if it is a cloudy day, you cannot see the sun, there's no way of knowing an eclipse. However, mathematically, you can deduce what days an eclipse happens. That's how we do it today. Earlier days also, our mathematicians did this. Even today, there are Sanskrit formulae, slokas, which is how the Panchanga guys get the eclipse right. How do you think a Panchanga, 1,000 years ago, 800 years ago, knew about eclipses? There were mathematical formulae that helped them deduce it. These were based on Ujjain as reference, and Ujjain is to the east or west or whatever, they would recalibrate it for the local Panchanga, which is why if you're in Bangalore, you should go by a Bangalore Panchanga, and if you go by a Madurai or some other Panchanga, the eclipse dates will be wrong. So science and technology information is also garnered from inscriptions. The director of Nehru Planetarium, Bangalore, has studied inscriptions, eclipse mentions and inscriptions for the last 2,000 years. And in collaboration with some other Japanese astronomers, they have deduced this reduction in the speed of rotation of Earth. Over 2000 years, the speed changes and varies, right? Mathematically, today we can calculate. But let's say an inscription mentions a date which is slightly off from what we calculate today. That's only because the Earth rotation speed has changed. They have written a thesis on this. So inscriptions are not just valid for old history. Modern day discoveries in science and technology also are, you know, some things that happen. And how we do it is based on the dates that we asked for. So we can figure the date, we can calculate formula today, and then we can understand. Very easy. I hope now you are convinced and it's not make-believe, as you thought it was.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you. Uday sir, this was fantastic, wonderful. And I've always loved history. Being an engineer by qualification, always loved history. And you made it all the more interesting.
Thank you again.
My question is around languages.
Okay.
I've always been fascinated by origin of languages and the etymology. So, this is an argument or a debate that I've had since my childhood with a lot of my friends, teachers, about which of the scripts came first. And, it's very interesting to see that we have all the three dominant scripts of the South visible in all the scriptures, all the inscriptions you have shared today. So there are two parts to my question. One part is, there are no instances of Prakrit, Sanskrit, or Pali in any of the inscriptions that that we have seen today. Is there a reason for that? There isn't any, even in Belur, Halebid, and other places, I have not seen much of Prakrit, Sanskrit, or Pali.
Right.
That is one question. Second is, on what basis was it decided about which language to use for the inscription? Was it based on the audience, donors, or the ruling king of Gangavadi, for instance? That's what I have to ask. Thank you.
So very interesting questions and also very delicate questions. So I'll answer them.
Oh, but no political aspect here.
First one. No, not at all. These are very good questions. Extraordinarily good questions. First one. Differentiate between script and language first. What I am talking in today is the English script. What names we are seeing written on our screens here is in the Roman script. I'm talking in English language. What is written is the Roman script. You can write, I can talk in English, and I can write the same thing in Kannada script or Tamil script or Devanagari script or any script. Please distinguish the two. Is that clear?
Right.
You can speak in Tamil, I can write the same thing in Kannada script. That is Lipi and language. This is the difference. Okay. So the question that you asked is, which is the oldest script? I'm literally using that same thing. Was that your question?
Partly, yes, sir. That's
okay. Right. All right. Because the answer is different for script and language. Okay. Script, all Indian scripts, wherever they are, whether it is in the south or east or west or north, not so much in the extreme east, but take it as Bengal. All have evolved from a script called Brahmi, B-R-A-H-M-I. Okay? Brahmi was used during Ashokan times, rather around, say, 2500 years ago. This was the script that has been used in the entire subcontinent for all languages. In southern Tamil Nadu, you will find Brahmi being used to write Tamil scripts. Tamil is this one. Okay? Over 2500 years, Brahmi has changed in its shape and form to evolve into regional scripts. Around the period of 500 AD, which is about 1500 years ago, it's Begur, right? So around the time that Begur was coming alive, new scripts were evolving from Brahmi into Kannada, into Tamil, into Telugu, into Punjabi, Gurmukhi, roughly, don't take all of them at 500, say between 500 to whatever, 800, 900 years, AD or something. slowly they branched away, and over the years, centuries, they look indistinguishable from each other today. Okay. If you think, if you go back in time, if you can read the Srinivagilu Kannada inscription, the whatever you called as Kannada inscription, and I go to Tamil Nadu, and let's say in Mahabalipuram, I can read them. They are, but the people will yell at me, this is not Kannada, this is Tamil. Okay, I can go to somewhere deep up, UP or MP or wherever, and read it. They will be surprised, you Kannadigas, you are from down south, how can you read this? The scripts were very similar those days. The languages that we are talking were different, that's all. Okay? Right. So mother script for most, except for a small, which is, and I'm going to just call, not even talk about it, Brahmi is the mother script. How it was used until about 500 AD in a place called Rajgatta, which is about 20 kilometers from my place. I'm sitting in Rajajnagar, near Dodbalapur. There is a pottery shreds with Brahmi inscriptions that have been found in, since you asked that second question, in Pali language. Okay. Now, it's very simple. Pali is rustic Sanskrit. Refined Pali, Prakrit is Sanskrit. Okay. So, Buddhists largely used it. Many Buddhist inscriptions are always in Pali, Prakrit or Brahmi. The nearest evidence of Brahmi being used in Bangalore is Rajgatta, where there was a Buddhist stupa and a Chaitanya found, the Chaitya found. Nobody even believes that Buddhism existed in Bangalore region. We have a solid evidence of Buddhism here. Very close. In 10 years, it will become an integral part of BBMP. Today it is suburban Bangalore. Yeah. But the second question was a very difficult, this one, political question. How do you see Tamil, Kannada, Telugu and all of that use here? Which language was chosen? Our perceptions, we cannot apply today's frames of references for the past. Today we are structured on linguistic grounds as Karnataka, Tamil Nadu, Telugu. Karnataka speaks Kannada, Tamil Nadu speaks Kannada, Tamil. Andhra, Telangana speak Telugu. This is a new notion. Okay. Typically, kingdoms spanned linguistic boundaries, always. If I take the Hoysalas, what is very little known, Hoysalas governed a large part of Tamil Nadu in the 13th and 14th centuries, 12th and 13th centuries. But if you ask anybody, Hoysalas, sir, Belur Alabit, sir, they are hardcore Kannadiga kings, sir. Not true. In fact, largest number of inscriptions in Bangalore or in Hoysala inscriptions period are in Tamil. Their capital, there are three capitals. One was Halebidu, second was Kannanur near Srirangam, third was Tirunmalai. Okay. So, imagine trying to tell the Hoysala capital of Srirangam, we'll have a bloodbath on our hands. Okay. Similarly, Cholas. The Cholas are, it is very incorrect to say they are exclusive Tamil kings. Not true. The Chola kingdom, different times, spanned modern day Tamil Nadu, Kerala, Karnataka, Andhra Pradesh, even Maharashtra. Portions of Bengal are also mentioned in as places that they have gone. Punjab and this one are also mentioned. Now, that is point one. Two is, dynasties were like our political parties today. Rampant intermarriage between dynasties happened all the time. If today we see a MLA in Congress and tomorrow is in BJP, it's quite normal, right? We'll accept him after a while. Happened in dynasties too. The Chola kings married Hoysala, Rashtrakuta, Ganga, God knows whoever, all of them. Now, if I marry, let's say I'm from Hoysala, or I say a Ganga king, who's considered hardcore Kannadiga.
Smart choice, Uday.
And I marry.
Marriage example, Nimune Tagombudre. Madi, Madi, Madi. The Anmur Hendi Tavale, example, Alanga.
Okay, let's say Badri is from Tamil Nadu. He marries a Ganga princess. What are his kids? Are they Kannadigas or Tamilians? I think it's a difficult question. What is the language of Badri? Is it Tamil or Kannada? Very hard to answer. So when we frame the past in today's terms, we get into all these messy situations. And remember, we are talking periods which are thousands of centuries, thousands of years. We are not talking something in the last 10 years or 10, 15 years or whatever. The reason for and places like Bangalore have always been multilingual. Because there's no line that says this village use only Kannada, next village is only Tamil. It's impossible. You know, life doesn't work like that. So here, Kannada, Tamil, and Telugu are native languages. It is unimaginable to say native today, because you will have a lot of people, you know, up in arms there. But this is the truth. And you will find Kannada inscriptions in Coimbatore, the Dharmapuri, Krishnagiri, Salem, E Road, Coimbatore, entire belt, a lot of Kannada inscriptions are there.
Yes, sir, I saw it in the Trichy temple also.
They are there. In Trichy Tanjore, yeah, okay, they're there. Trichy Tanjore, I think, are more recent, but I'm talking about 8th century, 9th century kind of periods. Okay. Now, so what happens if we start telling Dharmapuri, E Road, Salem, Coimbatore, I don't know where it goes, probably goes down to Tirunelveli as well. All of it belong to Karnataka. It'd be ridiculous to say that. In the same way, you know, you say the other way around. So I'll say, think about this. The inscriptions were intended for a certain audience. The temple priests were very, Shiva temple priests were largely Tamilians. In case. So if there's a temple grant being made for a priest, they wrote it in a language which he is best and at home with. So they use Grantha and they use Tamil. If it is written for someone else, let's say a merchant community who are at home with Kannada, they wrote it for them. If it was depending on the audience they wrote, number one. Number two, it also depended on the majority population there. Okay, if the majority of the people there were conversant with a certain language, they used it. Third problem, which we face today. Let's say the fellow who's writing that inscription, there is a person's job it is to do that. He or she is only conversant in a certain language. That's a limitation, right? Badri interrupted me and told, please use English today, right? So I switched to English because the majority of the population wanted English. However, if I were handicapped and I said I can only speak in Kannada, we had no choice to live with Kannada today. So the inscription author is that fellow. He knows only that, poor fellow. So this creates a peculiar situation. In some inscriptions, they use Kannada script to write Tamil instructions because that fellow only knew to write in Kannada. And the reverse. Okay.
But beautiful cohesiveness, isn't it?
So it's very hard to say, give one particular reason and say, they used Kannada because it was Kannada dynasty. They used Tamil because it was the Cholas. All that logic is kind of refuted by contrary examples. You have to look at each particular case and then decide what may have been the reason. I'll give one example just to make my point. Hoodi in Whitefield. Okay, there is an inscription in Tamil from 1346. Kilometer down is Sadarmangala. ITPL is Sadarmangala. Hoodi is just before that. Sadarmangala is a Tamil inscription 1 year later. Same king. No dynasty change. Now please help me understand, in 1 year, in 1 kilometer, how can we have a language change? It has happened. So, I think it's pretty hard to, come up and say hard line. Kannada means this, Tamil means that. Not possible.
So, sir, with your permission, I'll just add one more question before I say that. Thank you for that. This is a very interesting perspective and one that I am internalizing even as you are saying it.
Okay.
My addition to this question is, you know, it's a very childish notion. The child in me is thinking, if I had a time machine and I, you know, transported myself to that time, and with the language that I can speak all the three languages, Kannada, Telugu, and Tamil. But with the dialect that I have now, would I be able to communicate in those days? Because when you were reading out the Tamil, I could not understand it at all, for instance.
Why not? I think it's fairly simple Tamil. I'm not a Tamil speaker, so I may not have sounded right.
No, I didn't mean that. It sounded very literally and you understand.
Okay, don't worry. Depending on the period you went to, you would face that, you could easily converse or you would be in trouble. If you went to Srinivagalu 750 AD, no way you can speak and get away. Because that was Purvalai Kannada, still in its very early evolutionary time periods. None of the words, we use the same words today, but they're modified so much, they've changed so much, you can't speak that language. If you come to the 13th, 14th century, the cutoff period, I will say, is 1200, 300, 1300 periods. You could converse and not have an, you would still have one or two issues, but you would easily get past. Pre-1200 in any language, whether it's Kannada, Tamil, Telugu or whatever, you would be struggling. The longer back you go from there, there's a rapid change from 1000, for whatever reasons, I don't know. Rapid change in both script as well as language from there. So if you go to Begur 500 AD, none of us will be even considered as, you know, I would say, able to speak.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
Hey, Jaipal, you had a question. But before that,
not
just
a
to
question,
remind all
just
of you.
Just want to vote of thanks. Yeah.
To remind all of you, we are recording this, right? And we will gladly share this with all of us. Yeah. Over to you, Jaipal.
Yeah. Sir?
Yes, go ahead.
Yeah, I just want to thank you because it was a wonderful touch. And usually history means anyone can have a lecture for only 40 minutes. Now it is almost 2.5 years. I'm really still surprised that we can hear from your distinct word for another 2.5 years, there will be no boring subject. That with the fact you are really made everyone stay back and really wonderful section, sir. Thank you.
Thank you so much, sir. And the answer is very simple. I'm not a historian, neither are you. And both of us are using languages, we understand. That is all.
Thank you, sir. Good night. I think I'll take it.
Thank you.
For sure. Adya, I don't know if Adya is on. He had a question. Okay. If Adya is not there, KCN, sir, you had a question, sir. Go ahead. KCN, sir, you're on mute. Each one of you can unmute yourself. I don't have to do it. But let me find you and do it. You want me to? Vani Sudha. Oh.
Okay. Yeah. Sorry. Thank you. Sir, it was a wonderful session and really we came to know about the history of Bangalore. We are all thinking that Bangalore was Bendakaluru. Now we know that it's not Bendakaluru. It's much beyond. It's a mix of Telugu, Tamil, Kannada, I mean, all the kingdoms ruled us. And now, historically, we are all mixed up, you know. So, there is no much difference between Tamilian, Telugu, Kannadiga. So, nobody can say that, you know, Bangalore is divided on these languages, actually. See, basically, I am from Bangkolar. There is one temple, Someshwar temple in Marikuppam.
Yes.
Which is my grandparents' place. So they say that Someshwar temple in Madiwala, Kolar and Marikuppam, they're all built historically, maybe almost like 1,000 plus year old.
Right.
So I want to know one, maybe any history about Marikuppam or KJF area, especially when it comes to gold. You know, they were, basically domains were there. So it's they say that it's 100 plus year old, but I want to know more history about the gold mining in Kolar. Any light on that, sir?
So I don't know very much, but I'll only repeat what I've heard from scholars who have actually done some work on this. The fact that gold existed in the KGF region, Bangarpet region, is not something discovered or realized in the last couple of 100 years or 200 years. Gold has been supposed to have been extracted from there for thousands of years. At one time, it was the cap. The old name for Kolar was Kolala. It was a Ganga capital for a long time. The general belief, and again, metallurgy is the root, this one for this, sir. What we spoke about was inscriptions as a source for history. Metal archaeology, metallurgy was a big thing. Before something was written, the use of certain implements in certain places, jewelry, etc., etc., is the way we understand how there may have been connections. One of the things I have heard is they found golden jewelry in the Indus area, Mohenjo-daro and places like that. There is no gold source there. Okay. So there are also other indications that show that southern parts of India were a source for gold. Sandur or Kolar or some of these gold mines that we know today, they were also routes. So if I talk about the routes, the trade routes between north, south, east, west and all that, they went through trading places also. They went through such places, mines and places like that, whether it was copper, whether it was gold, whether it was iron, whether it was whatever. So one thing I've heard is Bangarpet KGF gold mine is not recent. The depths they are going to today and all may be recent. Gold has been extracted from that region. And it has been sent out to places as far as the Indus Valley or the Middle East, Middle Eastern civilizations and all for a long time. But I think much of what the questions that we are asking today are not being explored, are being explored today. I only repeated as, so consider this folklore or whatever, but substantiated by telling, look, how could there have been a gold in Mohenjo-daro? There is no gold there. And there are other evidences later on which indicate a line of villages, towns where golden jewelry has been found. That seems to lead to Bangarpet. That's the way it is. Much of history is being unearthed, sir. Everything that I told today, we can add much more next year when we meet. It is not at all true that everything is known. Thank you.
Thank you. And I was reading one more, old history that says that, Roman and our Sanskrit has single origin. Say that father, pitar, mother, matru, all that. See, you mentioned about the Brahmi script in India.
Yeah. Yeah.
So where is Sanskrit started? I mean, how it has started, how it has evolved? Or what is the link between Roman and Sanskrit and Brahmi?
We don't know. Okay. The honest answer is we don't know. But since you asked that, I'll answer it a little and add something else. The Tamil, Telugu, Kannada, Malayalam, some of the tribal languages, these are called as Dravidian languages. In the sense, please remember, the notion of Dravidian and Aryan has been not anymore considered as the way it was told. However, natively, let's say 3,000 years ago, 4,000 years ago, 5,000 years ago, people spoke here, something, right? So there is a version of that why is it that when you speak Tamil or Kannada or Telugu, there are certain common words? Okay, is because we go back in time to a common root. That root, that language is no more existing. It is called Proto-Dravidian. Okay, this work is going on. Nobody has still understood in full form or whatever it is. So there are dictionaries being developed called the Dravidian Etymological Dictionary and all of that. So the perception is that the intermingling of people from north and south and all of that has resulted in languages today. Now, whether the mother language was Sanskrit is, I don't think, established or understood well. Please remember, the language that was spoken largely then was Prakrit, not Sanskrit. The common man's language was Prakrit. And there are many, many flavors, versions of Prakrit, depending on where you go during the time periods. It's a continuous point evolution. Language or script or whatever is evolutionary in nature. It is not that suddenly one day something, you know, happened and somebody, you know, language is developed. It doesn't happen. So when somebody says, what is the mother script? I'll say, how long do you want to go? 1,000 years, 2,000 years, 3,000 years, 4,000 years, you'll have a different answer for everything that we go. In the study of languages, for some reason, say from the Ashokan period, which is 500 BC, to about 3,000 or, you know, BC, we have don't have understanding of the history here. This is not enough evidence. So there is a big gap between Indus Valley and Guptas and this one. So there are holes in our understanding today. And those holes, if you extend them logically, maybe in the next 100 years, we'll figure out and understand that, will tell us. But this idea of a mother language, mother script, is a poor way of thinking about it. If you go back in time, everything will change. So where do you put a halt to it and say, look, this is the mother language or mother script?
Fantastic. Any other questions?
I hope I'm not offending you, sir, because I come from a non-religious background. In the sense, for me, a lot of this comes from biology, science, as well as history.
Wonderful. Interesting. Yeah.
Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Thank you. I think we have taken a lot of time today. I think one of the longest meeting.
Wonderful
for, you know, sharing the details. Thank you. Take our question.
Thank you, sir.
Okay. Thank you. Thank you very much, sir.
I open. But really, sir, your mind is mind-blowing. You have everything in your mind. Thanks a lot.
Okay.
Super. Eye-opening section.
No.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you, everybody. Good night.
Bye. Bye, sir.
Thank you, everybody.
Bye-bye.